Good evening. Can you hear me now?
Hear me now.
Wave if you can hear me. Okay. See a lot of puzzled faces out there. Good evening. This is the regular meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. It's Monday, May 13th, and it is time to call the roll. Town Clerk, please.
Chairman Swift Kayada.
Here.
Councilor Barry.
Here.
Councilor Carson.
Here.
Councilor Fritz.
Here.
Councilor Lynch.
Here.
Councilor McGinty.
Here.
And Councilor Roberts.
Here.
And
manager.
We're both here.
Town manager and the municipal clerk. Please stand for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, first thing on our agenda is reports and correspondence from councilors. Any news? Jack. Councilor Roberts.
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to thank Debbie and her, I think it was 10 other election workers that spent a very quiet day at the polls. And I would also like to thank the approximately 250 people that bothered to come over to vote. It was a long day, but we appreciate those that did get out and do their civic duty. And so thank you very much. I also have I was asked by the Conservation Commission and the town planner if I would report on the Cape Trails Day that they're going to be having on June 1st. Cape Elizabeth is very fortunate that we have a number of trails in town. Most of them are maintained by the Conservation Commission or volunteers. The full text of the material is on the Cape Elizabeth website, www.capeelizabeth.com. So I'm not going to read it all since we have a very long meeting tonight. But the trails that people are going to be working on are Great Pond, Stonegate, Cross Hill, and Highland Trails. And it's in conjunction with the National Trails Celebration Day. So I would encourage you to check out the website. And if you are interested in trails and do enjoy them, please take this opportunity to get out and do a little work on them as well. So thank you.
Thank you. Anything else? Councilor Barry.
Madam Chairman, I've had several people I've talked to who may not be aware of, this is a note for veterans. Veterans of any military service, there is a program for prescriptions through the Togus Medical Facility in Maine, where for $7 per month per prescription, a veteran can get medical prescriptions. And this is a big savings for especially some of the senior citizens who are struggling on fixed incomes. And so for those who may not be familiar with the program, I just thought I'd mention it, that if they contact TOGUS and make an appointment with their DD Form 214, which is the discharge certificate, any veteran of military service of the United States can get these prescriptions for $7 per month per prescription, which is a huge saving for some of the folks who are taking a lot of medication, like me. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor Barry. Anything else? I have one thing to say, and that is that, like Councilor Roberts, I would like to thank everyone out there who voted for me. I appreciate being reelected. I appreciate your confidence in me, and I look forward to serving for another 3 years. I'd like to congratulate not only Councilor Roberts, but also George Entwistle, who was reelected to the school board, and Kathy Walsh, who was newly elected to the school board. So congratulations to them also. And I want to thank the municipal clerk and all her staff because they did a very good job of running the election, even though it was extremely quiet at the polls. But I was there from 7 in the morning till 8 at night, so I saw probably every single one of you 259 that voted. So I got a lot of good ideas because people, since it was so slow, people took the time to talk to me. I guess I must have looked like the Maytag repairman. It was a little lonely over there. So I got a lot of feedback on various issues, that things that are going on in town, and I got a lot of good ideas. So I want to thank you very much. Moving on, Town Manager's Report. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. I have quite a few items, but I'll go over them very quickly. First, I want to congratulate one of our new police officers, Scott Thompson. Late this last week, he was named president of his class at the Police Academy. that's now ongoing in Vassarburr, and that's a choice of the peers, of his peers. It's a very unique honor, particularly now that the police academy fully involves not only local police offices, but state police offices and county as well. He's also ranked academically at or near the very top of his class, so it's an indication of another fine police officer coming here to Cape Elizabeth. Also wanted to congratulate Sergeant Andy Steindl of the department and Officer Mark Dorval. Yesterday, during their 3 to 11 shift, these officers, with some help in one of the incidents by the rescue, were involved in saving the lives of two separate individuals at two separate incidents. And, you know, it's very rare that police officers, you know, be in that situation maybe once during a shift, but to have it happen twice during a shift, one of the patients, in fact, was very, very seriously, in a very, very serious situation. And as a result of the AEDs, the automatic defibrillators and the police cruisers, and as a result of a citizen as well providing artificial respiration, it was a life saved. So I really, you know, want to recognize the professionalism of those officers, as well as the rescue members and the private citizen who was involved as well. While I'm talking about police, I also want to thank all of those that have been involved in the construction of the new police and fire stations here in the town center. This includes the building committee led by Gilly Jordan, the architects Dost Associates, the builder Keeley Construction, the planning board, the town councilors who had the courage to vote for all these things over the years, the staff who's been involved in the project, the department heads and others, and really all others. This has come about after about 10 years of planning, and finally it's a reality. With the police department will be occupying their new space this Thursday, May 16th, and the fire department will then have full use of the space in the town center fire station, and both will also have an open house following Memorial Day exercise on Monday, May 27th. There is a handout here at the back of the chamber tonight that gives the full cost of the police station, because I know there's been a lot of questions on what the station has cost, but it's something that we're very proud of and believe that it'll be something that'll be enjoyed and utilized by the citizens for truly decades to come. I also want to thank Jimmy Murray, who's agreed to host the Memorial Day Parade again. It's going to be on the 27th, Monday, Memorial Day. The parade begins at 9 down at the Fowler Road intersection, and it continues with the exercises up between the two schools, up on Scott Dyer Road, and then again the open houses at the police and fire station. I want to thank the Public Works crew for all their help on cleanup week for this spring. It went about as fast as it's ever gone, and really appreciate everyone's cooperation throughout that activity. Also, our librarian, Jay Sherma, received a statewide award from an outfit called SIRS, S-I-R-S Publishing, on his defense of libraries being free from censorship. It's a very special award, and also the library is receiving a $500 award that will benefit the collection of the library as a result of Jay having been named to receive this honor. Finally, Councillor Fritz, Councillor McGinty, and I attended on Saturday night the Fire Department Appreciation Evening, and I want to congratulate Captain Mark Stouts of Engine 2 and Lieutenant Jason Grant of Engine 1 on receiving a John Civilly Award, which is the highest honor that is given out in the Fire Department for service to the department. Mark Stouts, as well as Tim Cram, also were recognized for completing their paramedic certification. The town has gone, as a result of a process, some action by the council, and some work by interested citizens, from one paramedic to three paramedics in about a year and a half, as well as having other paramedics who aren't directly affiliated with the rescue providing assistance as well. So it's a great improvement, I think, that, you know, helps to bring about results like we saw yesterday. Also want to thank, in the spirit of the recognition night, all of the members of the fire department, the WET team, the fire police unit, the rescue unit, Engine 1, Engine 2. I think I remember them all. It was a very well-attended evening, a lot of fun evening. It was really terrific to see the spirit amongst the volunteers. And while so many departments are having trouble now recruiting police officers, recruiting rescue members, fire department members, we've had fairly good success, and I think a lot of that is attributable to all of the volunteers there and how much they make everyone feel welcome, as well as the professionalism within our police ranks, as indicated by some of the things I've mentioned. So that's, I went on usually longer than I do, but had a lot of good news, and again, joining the council and thanking Deborah Lane as well.
Thank you very much. The next item is citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there anyone out there who would like to add something to the agenda? I see no one raising their hand, so I think we'll move on. The minutes of the meetings held April 8th and April 9th. Does anyone have any corrections or amendments?
Move acceptance of the minutes of April 8th and 9th.
Second.
If I could interject, I think there is a typo in a number in April 8th on page 5, the top of the page. I'll just give these. They're not significant, but there's that. And there's another one on the 429 workshop notes. I'll just give them to the municipal clerk afterwards. They're nothing significant, so just a number that's reversed. Okay, so it's been moved and seconded. All in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you. Okay, we have several items on the table. Do I hear a motion to remove any of these items from the table?
So moved.
Okay.
Second.
Second. It's been moved and seconded. I guess we should list that the items are number 109, 113, and 115.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Any discussion? All in favor of taking them off the table? Okay. It's unanimous. So item 109, which is action on a request from Councilor Berry pertaining to KeyBank charging a fee for cashing town payroll checks. And we have some material here. Councilor Berry, would you like to say something about this?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. This is not exactly involving town payroll checks exclusively. That was an example I used, and my point was several weeks ago, I received a check that was drawn on the Key Bank, and it was for less than $100. And I took it to the Key Bank to cash it, and I was told that I had to pay a $5 fee for cashing this check that was drawn on the Key Bank. In other words, if you had an account in the Key Bank and gave me a check for $100, and I took it to the Key Bank and cashed it, or attempted to cash it, they charged me $5 to cash your check. And I said, well, I've never heard of such a thing. And apparently the Key Bank is doing this in a number of places. So we did a survey of the local press has done a survey of the various lending institutions or commercial banks in the greater Portland area, and they found that the Key Bank was the only one that charged this fee. And so I said, well, for an example, if I had a $5 check payable to my order, and I did not have an account in the Key Bank, and I took that Key Bank check to the Key Bank and said, I'd like to cash this $5 check, they identified me, I endorsed it on the back, and gave it to them, they charged me $5 to cash the check. I said, well, that is a terrible policy. The Cape Elizabeth Town Council is a policy-setting body. We deal with matters of policy for the town. And I said, I think that is a terrible policy, and I think that there must be other commercial banks and financial institutions in the area that would do better in dealing with the public than charging a $5 fee for cashing a check drawn on their own bank. I think it's a gouge. And so for that reason, I have put the motion on the agenda to see if the council would go along with the following motion. And it is that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby directs the town manager forthwith to submit requests for proposals to each of the commercial banks doing business in Cape Elizabeth and South Portland to manage the checking account for the town and to report back to the town council on proposals received at the June 2002 meeting of the town council. So I'd make that motion.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
I second it.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there discussion or comments?
I would just say that it was not limited to town business. I think it's just a poor policy for any financial institution to adopt, and I think that there must be, in dealing with the public, a financial institution that would deal better with the public.
Would Mr. McGovern, there are a couple staff notes here. Would Mr. McGovern like to comment on those?
I appreciate Counselor Berry's consumer advocacy on this issue. You know, it's a difficult issue. I have provided some commentary to the town council on this issue with about 8 bullets, and I'll briefly go over them. I think one of the most important ones is that Counselor Berry has been successful in his effort to get Key Bank to change their policy. We do have a letter on the podium this evening from Key Bank indicating that the fee will be waived. So I want to thank Counselor Berry as a non-customer of Key Bank personally. If I should want to cash a check there, that would work out well.
Only under pressure, obviously.
That's right. The other reasons, I do have some concerns, though, with Counselor Berry's proposal on how to further address this issue, particularly since the bank has taken the initial first step. First is that Key Bank is the only commercial bank in the town with a night depository. The night depository is used for town and Portland headlight deposits. Requiring employees to go to South Portland creates both overtime and security issues. The town earlier this year ordered 20,000 accounts payable checks and 18,000 payroll checks at a cost of over $3,000. To date, we have used about $500 worth of the checks. If Councilor Berry's proposal changed and we switched banks, we would need to shred about $2,000 in pre-printed check stock. The immediate cost, direct cost of switching banks to printing and other miscellaneous costs would amount to $2,500. In addition, if travel time and mileage to South Portland is calculated at an average cost of $18 per day, the additional annual cost to the town is $4,500. The fee that had been in place for check cashing for those who did not exercise any of their other options would have amounted to $260 per year, assuming they never went to their own bank. As only 5 employees without key accounts used the Key Bank in Cape Elizabeth, the potential cost to them was an aggregate of $1,300. This still could have been avoided through the use of direct deposit by going to one's own bank or through opening an account at Key. I also listed 4 or 5 other reasons, but due to time, I won't go over them. The council has those, but I do, you know, personally appreciate Councilor Berry's efforts, and despite the length of time required to go to South Portland, I still agree in principle with Councilor Berry that it is important to solicit banking services from time to time. We have not done it for a while, and however, I do believe the timing of it would be more appropriate to do it sometime this fall after we've depleted some of our supply of pre-printed bank checks.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Is there further discussion?
Council? I'm shocked. I can drive from here to any bank in South Portland in the Mill Creek area within 10 minutes, and I'm shocked to hear how much overtime it would charge the town to do that. For a night deposit, we could go in any bank in South Portland and do that. There is also another bank in Cape Elizabeth that may not have a night deposit. But I just think it's a very poor policy to get a $5 check, go to cash the $5 check, have them keep it, and let me walk out. I think that's unfair. And I don't think we ought to support such a policy. And I just think we ought to make a survey of what's out there now. The motion has been made.
Thank
I know
you,
nobody seems to get excited about it, but I think it's a gouge.
Thank you, Councilor Berry. Are there other comments? Councilor Roberts.
I agree with Councilor Berry in the fact that it's a terrible policy, and I think people need to let the Key Bank know by voting with their feet. But it is important, I believe, for the municipal employees not to have to be traveling. The safety issue is much of my concern. Seeing them have to travel elsewhere when they can quickly and at odd times head right across the street or up the street in Cape Elizabeth. So I would be in favor of tabling it or delaying it till a later time when we can study it in an appropriate venue.
Further comments? Councilor Carson.
I didn't even want to speak, Henry. I did speak with Councilor Barry today about this, because I know he has serious concerns about it, but from our position, or my position as a town councilor, I felt that the initial reason that this was addressed, which was properly done by you, was because it affected town employees, and that was a great concern. I think the letter in hand from Key Bank said that you're absolutely right. We will not charge town employees who cash checks at our bank there. But I'm not sure that it's my responsibility to see that citizens in Cape Elizabeth decide whether they should go to Key Bank or Fleet Bank or drive to Mill Creek or whatever. I'm not really, I mean, I wanted to support you, Henry, but I did think about this, and I just think that this is, you know, I can't seem to put myself in that position that I should be solving the problems of the banking industry on the town council in Cape Elizabeth. I just couldn't seem to get it, because if I can't cash a check there, I'm going to go someplace else. But the employees, because Key Bank did come forward and not charge that fee to employees, I felt that sort of solved our problem at the time. So I can't, this is, you know, the manager's busy. We could do a survey on our own. I could sit in my office and call every bank probably and ask them whether they do that, and we didn't probably have the survey.
Well, the newspapers have already done that.
Then why do we need the survey? They've already done it?
No, well, I don't know.
Have they?
Through the chair, Madam Chairman.
Yes.
We're talking about two different things. You're talking about a survey, and what I'm talking about is a request for proposals to the business.
The motion is to submit requests for proposal from to each of the banks, the commercial banks.
As set forth on the agenda.
Oh, well, then of the two issues, I think we've solved one with our employees. They can cash the checks over there, and I guess I can't support at this time changing banks. But I would reconsider this at another time.
I didn't suggest a change of bank. I just said do a survey.
Councilor McGinty?
Ditto.
For proposal.
She said it. I mean, the original problem was the town employees, and that has been resolved by Key Bank. And again, I don't think it's a policy decision making of the town council on what Key Bank's cash checking policy should be.
Any further comments? No? It's been moved and seconded. Let's move the question. It's, just to read it back, is to direct the town manager to submit requests for proposal to each of the commercial banks doing business in Cape and South Portland. So all those in favor? Two. All those opposed? Five. Thank you very much. The motion fails. Okay. Item number 113, action on proposed restructuring of Maine Municipal Employees Health Trust. Mr. Manager?
I would recommend that the restructuring be approved.
So moved.
I do hear a motion. Does anyone want a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion?
No. Move it along.
No. All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you. The next item is item number 115, action on installation of a small speaker system at New Lions Field. Mr. Manager, I note that the Cape Elizabeth Little League has withdrawn this request. So does anyone have a motion to...
I'll move that since the Little League withdrew the request, that we table this item indefinitely.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion?
None.
Hearing none. All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you.
Point of order, Madam Chairman. Is it appropriate to discuss a motion to table, or do you just have to vote?
It's non-debatable.
I don't...
You just have to vote on it.
Yes.
That's right.
I don't think it's non-debatable. It's non-debatable.
Right.
Sorry. Thank you very much. Those who know Robert's rules better than I do. Okay. next, we're coming to a variety of items set for public hearing or public comments. The first one is item number 117, which is a public hearing on proposed revisions to the zoning ordinance. Councillor Lynch is the chair of the ordinance committee. Would you like to introduce this, please?
I'll try and introduce it and be brief in light of the large number of people that I think are here for other matters. So the genesis of this proposal came from the Inn by the Sea, which has inadequate parking at times in the summer, particularly when they have larger functions like weddings, And so they originally proposed that, working with St. Bartholomew's, that in-by-the-sea parking could take place at St. Bartholomew's Church. This was not permitted under our current ordinances, so both the planning board and the ordinance committee has reviewed this, and what's before the council tonight is a proposed ordinance that would permit off-site parking in other legal parking lots off-site from the location requiring the parking. It's important, I think, to note that the proposed ordinance would apply to the town center zone as well as the zone where the in-by-the-sea is located. So those are the two areas of the town that would be affected by this proposal. Under the draft ordinance, off-site parking would be permitted elsewhere on an existing parking lot with site plan approval after the planning board determines that parking is adequate for the multiple uses and reviews traffic impacts. For example, in the particular case of in-by-the-sea, the planning board would have to determine that the parking would be adequate at St. Bartholomew's for the functions or services that they hold, as well as the functions that will be held simultaneously by in-by-the-sea. If a lot has never received site plan approval, then the off-site parking would be permitted, provided that the planning board has reviewed the lot for traffic access, parking, lighting, landscape, and buffering, something that they would normally do when they're approving parking lots. This proposed ordinance received the unanimous approval of the ordinance committee, made up of councilors McGinty, Fritz, and myself. And I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much, Councilor Lynch. Okay, this is a public hearing on these proposed revisions, and the way the public hearing goes is that people who would like to speak should come up to the podium and state their name and address and give us any comments that they have. So I declare this public hearing open. Doesn't seem to be a hot topic. Nobody out there, right? Wave your hand if you're just coming up slowly. Okay. Then I declare the public hearing closed.
I would move adoption of the new off-site parking amendment as set forth in our agenda tonight.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion?
One question.
Councilor Roberts.
Chairwoman. Yes, when I was reading that, it struck me that they could have parking a mile away, but there was nothing in their citing that they had to provide shuttle service. Should that be part of that recommendation, that that has to be provided? Otherwise, they can... A group could show parking a mile away, but if there's nothing, no transportation being provided, they're still probably going to park illegally near the site of where the activity is taking place.
Councilor Lynch, was that...
I can't say that we discussed that issue. It came to us in the form of the in-by-the-sea, I think, prepared to provide a shuttle service.
Also, but theoretically, the parking could be right across the street also. So, I mean, you wouldn't necessarily have to provide shuttle service across the street, theoretically.
Who's ever?
Yeah. I'm going to support the change. I was just curious. It just seemed rather curious that if they were using that as a...
Councilor Carson? Excuse me. Councilor Carson?
I was just saying, who's ever having the event is not going to have their people walking there saying, this is the off-street location, we'll pick you up. They're not going to... There's not going to be 100 people walking down 77 to get to an event, I don't think.
No, that's exactly what I'm saying. My sense is they could use that to cover the requirement of the law, but still have people parking on Route 77.
We can police that.
I would suggest that we can watch that. The planning and the code enforcement officer has adequate power to enforce the parking, and if it's a problem, we can certainly take it up again. But
thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? Okay. It's been moved and seconded. All in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Thank you, Councilor Lynch. Moving on. We have item number 118, which is public comments and decision on proposed improvements to Fowler Road. Mr. McGovern, would you like to just set this one up for us?
I will briefly. This was also the topic of a forum a week ago this evening, attended by a number of Fowler Road area residents and by the town engineer, by the Public Works Director, and by most of the town council members. We ran into some problems with some attempts to repair Fowler Road, looked at many different alternatives. The alternative that was arrived at, recommended by the town engineer, was to shim the road from essentially Fowler Road from Route 77 to Route 77, and then to put an overlay, new pavement on it. The other alternatives were widening the road, moving the utility poles back, which the state was requiring us to do, clearing a lot of trees, perhaps losing some of the canopy. The citizens who were at the meeting, of those who indicated an opinion, who lived in the neighborhood, I think it was unanimous with the show of hands that they favored the particular option that's recommended in this agenda, which is to shim the road and then to overlay it. I would reserve any other comments unless there's questions from the public.
And that was the option that was called Option 2 at the meeting last week?
It was called Option 2, correct.
Just for everyone who might be watching who was at last week's meeting. Okay, thank you for that introduction. I suppose we should hear, since it's not an official public hearing, we should have a motion and then ask for comments.
I would move that the town council approve alternative number 2, shimming and overlay of Fowler Road, as proposed by the town engineer and the town manager, to be directed to request the Maine Department of Transportation to transfer the state and federal funds originally designated for Fowler Road to a program to continue the overlaying of Route 77 from Scarborough Line, extending back into Cape Elizabeth as far as the funds will permit.
A second.
It's been moved and seconded. At this time, I'd like to ask if there's anyone who would like, anyone out in the audience who would like to make a comment. We had a number of people asking questions and making comments last week at the meeting for Fowler Road residents, but anyone else is welcome to come on up, whether they're a resident of Fowler Road or not. Yes, thank you. Could you please come forward to the podium and just state your name and address, please?
Charlene Andrews and 15 Grover Road, Cape Elizabeth.
Thank you.
And I was just wondering if anything is proposed for Route 77 coming into Cape Elizabeth, but not the Scarborough line.
Coming in from Scarborough, that end?
No, coming in from
South Portland.
Ocean House Road
on 77.
Could you address that, Mr. McGovern?
The Maine Department of Transportation has already set aside funds to pave Route 77 from the South Portland line all the way to Fowler Road.
Okay.
That's why that wasn't in this specific graph.
Okay. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. Any other comments or questions from people in the audience? Okay. Is there any discussion amongst the councilors or questions? Hearing none, let's move the question. All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Okay, we have a consent agenda here with three items, items number 119 through 121. And does anyone want to make a motion about these? Take them together or separately or?
I'll move that we take items 119, 120, and 121. Up together, and I will just read what they are so the public can sue that. Item number 119 is a request to refer to the planning board that Purpooted Club have the word, in quotes, golf course as a permitted use in the RA and RB zoning districts and to include in the ordinance a definition of the words golf course. Item number 120 is a request from the Portland Amateur Wireless Association to utilize Fort Williams Park for their annual field day, which has already been approved by the Fort Williams Advisory Committee. Item number 121 is a request from the Portland Yacht Club to use Fort Williams Park on August 10th, 2002, after regular hours for the possible after-hours finish of the Monhegan Island Race, with the understanding that the after-hours use is for race officials only, and this has also been approved by the Fort Williams Advisory Committee. And I move that we take these up together as a consent.
Second.
And moved and seconded. All in favor of taking them at once? Okay. I guess we just approved them. Was that just to take them at once?
That was just to take them up together.
Okay,
I'll
then
move approval of all three.
Second. Any discussion?
I just have a question on the yacht club. What are regular hours?
Sundown, sun up to sundown. And the race, some boats may finish after sundown, so.
I see. It said August 10th and 11th, so.
Right.
They're not going to go after midnight, I guess, unless they get a slow boat.
Well, they would might. They have a slow boat.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions or comments? It's been moved and seconded. All in favor? It's unanimous. Counselor Roberts, did you? I didn't see that hand go up. Yes, okay.
Next item.
It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Okay. Moving on. Okay, next we're moving to a report from the Town Council's Finance Committee, and I have a strong suspicion that that's what many of you, if not most of you, are here to find out about. All these items, the council may discuss and consider all these items as a block or separately, if the council wants to do so. Just to lay out for you what the process is, first of all, the Finance Committee Chair, who is Councilor Roberts, will first present a brief overview of the Finance Committee's recommendations and conclusions. Secondly, after his remarks, we'll have time for comments from the public. And lastly, the council will vote on whether to set any or all of these items for public hearings and formal council votes on May 28th, 2002. So I hope that's clear for everyone. Councilor Roberts, I'm going to turn it over to you, and then we'll come back to me and go forward from there. I assume you're going to want to use this PowerPoint thing, so some of us are going to have to move.
Right, I'll make a couple of comments first. I would like very much to thank everybody for coming tonight, and I especially want to thank Mr. McGovern and his staff for their effort, Tom Fisella and his staff, the school board, and my fellow councilors for all the work that's put into the budget this year. Putting together a budget in an uncertain economic climate is no fun. I can assure you that. But everyone has worked very hard to balance the needs and the ability to pay. The presentation that I will give you to this evening goes back to November when serious discussions began. So, okay, thank you. The economy and local budgets is our first slide this evening. The world changes, and so does the local economy. The Town Council and the School Board met on November 15 of this past year, reviewing the impact of the economy on our local taxpayers and on our budgets. At that time, everyone is encouraged to try and find savings in the current year due to a likely loss of state revenues and flat in revenues elsewhere. The CPI is for the past 12 months is up 5.5%.
The state 1.5.
1.5, excuse me, for the last 12 months.
Tell people what CPI stands for.
The Consumer Price Index, for those of you who are not familiar with that initial. The state fiscal picture for the coming year is uncertain. Town revenues are flat, except for the decline in the general purpose aid to education, state revenue sharing, and investment income and cable fees, which are all down. The short-term investment rates from the date of the first budget workshop of this year to present, you can see where they have gone. November, we were getting 6.16%. In May 10, it is now down to 1.75%. Not only does the town lose this kind of revenue, but people on fixed incomes who depend on their revenues from investments are also taking a hit. As you can see, again, the news is down on the revenues and investment incomes. Will investment interest rates increase? We certainly hope so. Will the state give us more or less money? Well, I guess we can all figure that one out pretty fast. How much can the taxpayers be asked to pay? What will be the impact of the revaluation? And that will be big next year. Will car sales slow with fewer incentives? None of us really know the answers to most of these questions. The council responds to the changing economy. The council asked the town manager for a budget with no more than a 3% expenditure increase back in November. At the same time, we wrote to the school board asking them to consider a similar restraint. We reviewed potential sources of revenue, and we lobbied the state for additional state school funds. And we were fortunate in that we were able to get some monies. We were originally looking at close to $700,000 loss, and we managed to get it down to $432,000 with the help of our state representatives. The Finance Committee review. We went over the budget presented by the manager and his department heads with a fine-tooth comb, and we reduced municipal spending increase to 2.42%. We have asked the school board to limit their expenditure increase to 4% from the 5.4% that was originally requested. We have proposed significant hikes in permit fees and in other areas. And the tax rate increase now proposed at 4.33% translates to 94 cents per thousand. The school tax increase of 67 cents, the school state subsidy is $445,714 less than last year. Other school revenues are up, which is the good news, $162,401. Lower school revenues amount to a net of $230,535, and therefore the impact on the tax rate is 31 cents. Additional school expenditures equate to 36 cents on the tax rate. The municipal tax increase of 11 cents, town revenues will be flat, assuming fee increases that are in the proposal are approved by the council. Town spending increase of $167,978 adds 11 cents to the tax rate. Town and schools both benefit from the new valuation from homes that have been built this past year, and this amounted to an additional $430,000 in tax revenue. The county tax increase of 16 cents. This is a budget that is out of our control. The council voted to reject approving this particular budget, but we still have to pay the bill. Spending by Cumberland County as a result is up. And it's part of your local property tax. Therefore, the net loss of school revenues and the increase in the county tax amount to 47 cents of the proposed total 94 cent tax increase. Why did the council vote to provide the schools a spending increase of 4%? School electricity costs are down $66,009. And heating costs are down $16,600 prior to additional $27,000 that has been found in savings. School debt service is down $12,802. Excluding the above, school spending is up 4.8%. Class sizes at the high school appear to be well below the school board policy of 22. The majority of the town council believes 4% is fair, considering the local economy, the uncertainty over state finances, flat enrollment, the 1.5% CPI, energy savings, high school class sizes below school board policy, the loss of a net $230,545 in school revenue from the GPA and our concern for taxpayers on fixed incomes. The majority of the town council believes the school system can continue its excellence with a 4% increase without cutting a single program affecting students. The school board is solely responsible for deciding the specifics of the school board budget, of the school budget. Total spending for all purposes is up $990,852. Including special funds, we now spend over $25 million each year. The town council proposed tax rate increase is 4.33%, or more than double the rate of inflation. And a summary of our spending increase as proposed at the present time is 11 cents on the municipal, 36 cents for school, 31 cents for the net school revenue loss, and a county tax increase of 16 cents for a total of 94 cents. It's been a tough year, and we appreciate everybody's patience and the work they put into this. And Madam Chair, at that point, I would turn it back to you.
Great. Thank you very much. I don't know, but I hope you can.
Michael, can you help me around?
Okay, thank you, Councilor Roberts, and Finance Chair, Councilor Roberts. Just a few words before we start. Now is the time for comments from the public, but this will not be the only time. The next meeting that we have, which is, I believe, May 28th, will be when we have a formal public hearing. But the school board suggested at our last joint meeting together that they would, they thought it was a good idea, and we agreed to have more opportunities for citizens to weigh in about what they thought on various issues. So while this is not a formal public hearing, it is a time for public comment. So we're looking for comments on a number of areas. First, on revenues, as you could see from Councilor Roberts's presentation, and I believe there's a handout up in the back. Something. Well, I don't know if you can tell what it looks like. I think it's on white paper, right? White paper that it talks about the review of Finance Committee recommendations. That sort of walks you through. It's a summary of that kind of stuff that he just went over. But so first, we're looking for feedback on revenues. To see if anyone disagrees with the Finance Committee's consensus that the town should cover 100% of the school's net lost revenue. So this is the time to speak if you agree or disagree with that. Secondly, regarding spending, we're looking for feedback on the Finance Committee's consensus to approve no more nor less than an increase of 4%. And thirdly, and please note this particularly, the town council cannot decide how to allocate the increase in spending. Why, you ask? Because I've gotten a number of emails on this and people want to know why. Well, because under the town charter, the town council is charged with setting the limit, you know, the total amount of the school budget. By charter, only the school board may decide exactly how to spend those dollars. During the proposal process, the budget proposal process that we've been going through for the past months, the council needs to know what the budget is being spent on so that it can make a fair judgment about what the total amount should be, but it is the school board's job to make decisions about what their educational priorities are within that amount. As an example, of how this works, the board told the council in their letter of last week to us that if they were not going to be able to get more than a 4% increase, that they would have to cut some programs and staff, including support for freshman athletics and funding for field trips, as well as maintenance for schools. As a parent of someone who is in the schools and a daughter who just recently graduated, I have a lot of concerns. And if this were a school board meeting, I, as a parent, would encourage board members to avoid cuts that directly hurt schoolchildren, if at all possible, teaching staff, to avoid hurting teaching staff or programs, and to instead focus on savings like decreasing architectural design fees or putting off buying a new freezer for the high school. But as town councilors, we get to have opinions, but we don't get to make those decisions. So having said all that, that doesn't mean that we don't want to hear what you have to say. Anyone who wishes to speak about anything on the school budget may do so, even if it's about things that the council is not going to be able to decide on. There are a number of school board members here, and the superintendent is here, and I'm sure they would like to hear what you have to say about specifics and your educational priorities for your children. I believe there's also a school board meeting tomorrow, the regularly scheduled school board meeting tomorrow, at which I'm sure there'd be an opportunity for you to speak to. We have quite a few people here, so in the interest of saving the time that you have to spend at this meeting tonight, I would ask that you please keep your comments brief and to the point so that everyone who wants to speak may do so. Also, it helps speed things up if people come up to the podium and line up to speak. It doesn't have to be, you know, like 50 people long, but at least if it's a few people long, it keeps things moving as opposed to one person going up and then one back and then one up and one back. We get a lot of traffic time going back and forth. So it would be helpful. It's certainly up to you. If that works for you, fine. We're here for the duration, so whatever works for you works for us. And could you please state your name and address into the microphone so everybody who's at home watching on TV will know who is speaking, because sometimes they're just seeing sort of the side of your head and don't know who you are. Anyways. And there's plenty of free seats in the front, too. I noticed there are people, the manager noticed that there are people standing in the back. So if you'd like to sit down, feel free to come up front, although somehow it seems like my church, nobody wants to sit in the front row ever. So... having said all that, I hope the process is clear. Who wants to go first? And please step to the podium. Yes, sir.
My name is Frank Potenzo, Ivy Road. Lived in the same house for 44 years. A couple of comments on possible savings. Size of classrooms, median is 16. Maybe some of those classrooms have less than 16. Instead of purchasing, what I heard was the possibility of three portable classrooms coming up in the near future. Why not just add five or six more students to per classroom? I think teachers are getting paid enough that they'd be able to stand withstand, I guess, a small increase in classroom size. That should eliminate the possibility of purchasing portable classrooms. Maybe that's not feasible. I also heard that the high school wants to purchase a new freezer, approximately $25,000-$30,000, but that it could be repaired for about $2,000. Now, I realize that if you pay $2,000 a year for the next 2-3 years, you've still got an old freezer, but even 2 or 3 years at $2,000 is only $6,000 compared to $25,000 or $30,000, because we don't know what the freezer is going to cost 3 years from now or 4 years from now. It might be $40,000. But anyway, just those two comments. And we're living in drastic times where money is short from the state and local revenues. And I think we have to take drastic measures somewhere to offset the loss of revenues. But just to, you know, what the town and what the high school wants, what the town or the high school would like to have, and what the town or high school absolutely needs, those are three different avenues to take. And living in Cape Elizabeth, if you ask the rest of the state what they think of Cape Elizabeth, they'll say, oh, everyone's rich there, and so it doesn't make any difference what the tax rate is. But still, 30% of approximately 9,000 residents in Cape are 60 years of age or older. and that means about 3,000 residents of Cape are what we call senior citizens. And a lot of the senior citizens, not only in Cape, but South Portland and other towns, are worried that they would not be able to continue to live in their homes if the tax rate keeps going up and up and up. But, you know, according to insurance statistics, 3 out of 5 people aged 65 today will live to be 85. 2 out of 5 will live to be 90, and 1 out of 5 will live to be 95. Now, if things get worse as far as property taxes, and a husband and wife or a single resident in a home where they had 2 or 3 or 4 children, and now those kids are all grown after going through the school system, now you've got a couple or a single individual living in a home that has 3 or 4 bedrooms, bathrooms. If they all of a sudden turn around and sell their homes to a couple that's got 4 or 5 kids, that's going to be another problem for Cape with a larger enrollment. So I would think that the town would like to keep the retired people in their homes because they don't ask for much and they have no kids in school, but they're still paying quite a bit for families that do have children in school. But I think the spending habits in Cape have to be reined in somehow. I realize the budget, the whole overall budget, 85% goes to the school. There's not much you can carve out of it, but you can stop spending that is really not necessary, if you could find anything that isn't necessary. One last thing, there's a little anecdote I read somewhere. That in this small town on the outskirts was a dangerous road, big curve in the road. The council got together and they couldn't figure out why so many accidents were happening. People were being killed. So they decided to take a vote and see if they should build a hospital near the site of that curve to take care of all these people getting maimed and killed. And a small voice in the council chamber said, why not just fix the curve in the road and instead of spending a couple of million for a hospital? That could perhaps lend itself to a lot of things that go on in Cape as far as spending money for a lot of fringe things that, you know. One last thing, and that is the residents of this town going to be losing the spring cleanup. A couple of years ago, the town said you can't use the plastic bags, you have to use paper bags. So the town for a couple of years furnished paper bags to all the residents if they wanted to go pick them up, or they can go to the hardware store and buy them. And I understand that by not giving the residents those paper bags, the town saved about $8,000. Now they're going to save $15,000. By not having the spring cleanup. The townspeople are going to have to find somebody else to haul all that stuff away, especially brush and trees that have been cut down and so forth. And I think that's taking something away from residents that shouldn't be done. I don't know what the town really does for residents. Of course, they pave the roads in front of your house once in a while. But what else is given to residents of this town as far as the fringe benefit, like the spring and fall cleanup, like providing paper bags? So these are some of the things that, you know, and it's fortunate that we have many volunteer groups, whether they're through the high school, sports groups, or whatever, that raise money to pay for things to make the town better in many ways. There are so many organizations, I can't name them all, but being a Cape Lion, I'd like to put in a good plug for the Cape Lions Club, who contribute yearly scholarships for the high school, money for Boys and Girls, Derrigo State. We give money to the Cape Rescue Unit, Fire Department, Police Department, Triad, Wet Team, Little League. We work very hard for what we earn from our projects. And it all goes back into making Cape Elizabeth a better place to live. And one last thing, with the pancake breakfast, ladies, Mother's Day pancake breakfast yesterday, 7:30 to 11, about 11:30, when it was all over, Dudley Bostwick, who's a member of the Lions Club, came into the clubhouse asking if the lucky ticket had been drawn that won his painting. He no sooner got in the entrance that he collapsed. And we called the rescue unit immediately. Within seconds, two police cruisers were there, the rescue unit was there, and he was technically dead. But they revived him, took him into the hospital, and today had triple heart bypass. So hopefully he's going to be all right. But the rescue unit, I can't say enough good about them. And anybody in this town that gets some kind of a request from the rescue unit for funds should dig deep and contribute. Thank you all.
Thank you very much. Dr. Purcell.
Good evening, Tom Purcell, Superintendent of Schools. I won't take a lot of time. I know the school board has spent some time with the council going over some of the facts and figures included in the budget. And I know that the school board has the list of their facts and the council has their facts. And as facts are, they don't always agree. I'm looking at the sheet that looks at the summary of proposed tax rate, and I think a lot of it isn't the way it's presented. And municipal spending 11 cents, school spending 36 cents, net school revenue 31 cents, county tax increase 16 cents. I think about 4 days ago, Mike McGovern shared with me a similar chart that had school spending at 9 cents and the revenue loss from the state. So I think it's all in how you want to present the numbers. The bottom line is it's still 94 cents. I think the total loss in revenue from the state adds up to about 60 cents of the loss that we're taking. I understand the way this is being presented is taking all of the revenue together, which isn't the way we've presented that in the past. A couple of other issues I have with just some of the points, and maybe would like to clarify from the school board's perspective. It was a charge for the school to show similar restraint in preparing their budget. And when asked that question, and when we were given that charge, I think what we looked at was, what does that mean? Does that mean 3%? We were told, no, there is not an exact number. Similar restraint would be looking at what you're spending, trying to hold that spending down in a similar manner, at least we thought, as to the town. The town has increased its budget due to salaries and benefits. I think there's a half-time custodian, and there is also some mandated fees that you have to pay. The school budget, if held to 4%, will not even cover the increase in salaries and benefits. So in that estimation, the salaries and benefits alone at 4.2% and the increase in mandated special ed brings our budget up to an increase of 5%. Just taking care of those particular issues. So I think the school board, in presenting their budget, thought they were showing similar restraint to the town, because we were holding, for the most part, our budget to negotiated salary and benefit increases. Also, in looking at the number of 5.34% on an increase of our budget, in that, included within that on the expense side of the budget is $60,000 for the expense of a school bus. We are paying, as you know, and trying to save money out of this year's budget. We're only listing that school bus on the expense side because in order to receive state funding, we have to list that as an expense. The $60,000, we are not purchasing that bus out of next year's budget. That already brings that budget down below 5%. And then also there's the $33,000 in savings we did not realize that we were going to have in fuel and telephone until after the budget was proposed. So the reality of our budget increase is at 4.7% in a real figure, not even cutting anything, which would be the smallest increase in 3 or 4 years rather than the largest since 1995. Also, I would like to address just the fact that a 4% increase in spending obviously is the largest amount of school spending ever in Cape Elizabeth. If we went up by a dollar, it would be the largest increase, the largest budget that we've ever had for a school budget. And lastly, our class size seems to have been an issue. We do have a policy on class size. We try to hold to that policy. I can say that the figure of 16 students per class is not accurate. Part of an agreement we worked out with the high school this year, because we are experiencing an enrollment increase at the high school of 50 students, the original request from the high school was for 3.5 teachers. They've cut that back down to 1.3 teachers, and actually the teachers at the high school in their total class load will be gaining 8 students per teacher. We tend to like a look at class sizes at the high school in terms of class load. Most teachers at the high school have around 80, 78, 90, some have 95 students. There's a huge difference if we held to, which you can't do in a high school anyway, you cannot put exactly 22 students in every classroom. If we had that kind of a figure, every teacher would have well over 100 students. It's obvious that if you're an English teacher and you're giving any kind of a writing assignment to correct over 100 papers compared to 80 papers is significant. Most of the research will tell you that you want to get around, at the maximum, that 80 in the classroom, which is the policy of many of our neighboring communities. Also, at the high school, when you look at class size, some of our numbers are 17, 19, they range 22, 24. Very difficult to take an average, especially since some teachers have classes with 5 students, 3 students, 4 students, but all of those different classes are in the same teacher's classroom for that given period, so you really can't take that kind of an average. If I had to pick out an average number per class, it would probably be about 19 students per class in the high school. Is that at the 22 students that the board recommends to look at for an average size at the high school? No. The problem we run into at the high school is when 34 students sign up for a class and are only 2 sections of that class, the decision the high school has to make is to not allow many students to take that class, create 2 sections of 17, or have 1 section of 34 students. It's very difficult to offer the kind of program and the quality of program we have at Cape Elizabeth High School and maintain exactly 22 students in every classroom. So those are just some comments that I have that although it looks to me that your facts are pretty close, I think it's a lot of it is left up to interpretation, how you interpret those facts. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, ma'am.
Barbara Schenkel, 32 Belfield Road. I'd like to commend the council for urging fiscal restraint. Last year, our taxes went up 7%. This will be another 4%, vastly exceeding the consumer price index increase for both years. I think that if people are serious about cutting budgets, they can, and they should be urged to do so. I have looked at the school budget in the past and feel that there are areas where things can be cut, slimmed down. It seems to me we try to give everything to everybody, and we can't always do that. So I encourage you to stick to your guns. I think 4% is generous, especially in light of inflation. And I think we need to be very careful, since we have had a hefty tax increase last year and are facing another increase this year. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, ma'am.
Hi. I'm Bonnie Steinroder. I live at 1 Gateledge Drive. Two brief comments. The first is, though I understand very much how the temptation is to set different groups of people up against the other. You know, it's traditional in human society. When the pie gets smaller, we all fight for a piece of that pie. But we are one community. What benefits our older people benefits our younger people. I'm a mother, but I'm also a daughter. And so I just don't think it's helpful to set it up that either the older people get to stay in their homes or our children get their education. And so it gets very emotional for me when I hear people say things like we've been trying to give everything to everyone, when we just heard our superintendent say that one of the main things that we'll be having to cut back on or not meet are the already very low salaries and benefits of our teachers. If you look at the list, we're still near the bottom of towns of what we offer. So to say, you know, we have to make the cuts and we have to be very frugal, we're talking about other people's salaries and livelihood and compensation, and they don't get paid nearly enough. And even adding one extra child to a classroom makes a huge difference. So I guess I just want us to be really aware when we're talking about these things that we're talking about human beings and not just numbers in a budget.
Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Gail Atkins. I live at 1189 Shore Road. I don't really want to be here. I'd rather be home. I didn't want to be at the school board meeting a couple of weeks ago either, but I started something a year and a half ago that has gotten me involved in these meetings. I wanted to reinstate Latin in the high school. We are the only high school locally that does not offer a Latin program. We used to, so that's why I say we're trying to reinstate it. One of the problems I run up against, as always, is the budget. Last year, they were prepared to reinstate Latin for this school year, but they needed the extra funds for the middle school. So they said, well, we're going to do it the following year when we have the larger bubble of students coming through, and we're going to need the extra classes, we're going to need extra courses for these additional students. So Latin was put on the curriculum load. 58 students signed up for it, showing that there's a real interest by the students for this program. It's a beneficial program. At the school board meeting, they were discussing Latin versus choral arts. You never know what program is going to inspire a student, and I don't want to pit one program against another program. You need something for everyone. But consequently, I think Latin still may be on the fence. I'm here to do something that used to really annoy me. I used to be in real estate development, and I used to spend my evenings out presenting projects at towns. And the one thing that used to annoy me is when I had spent months and months presenting a project, and then we had that public hearing, and people came forward who'd never stepped foot at any of those other meetings and started to complain about this or that or whatever. And I am here to vent. And I have to admit, I've never been to any of the public hearings or any of the meetings, planning board meetings, for any of the recent local projects that we've had in the town. I haven't been to any of the town council meetings. But every year there always seems to be a problem with the school board budget. And every year people are always fighting for something for the students. And something always seems to have to get cut. And yet I look around the town, drive around as I go to the dump, drive through town, and we have a new public works building, we have a new fire department building, we have a new police building. I don't think anyone in this town would question that those buildings weren't needed and that the employees that work in those buildings do a wonderful job for this community and that they deserve a nice place to work. But I think we've also given them the more than the Cadillac of buildings, I think we've given them the Range Rovers of buildings. The school board meeting, Jeff Shedd made a number of cuts at the high school, but he was still looking for $45,000, and as I understand it, we have $50,000 worth of rocks sitting across the street. As I said, I used to work in real estate development, and a developer will not build a project unless he's going to make a profit. And as that project is being built, you're constantly reevaluating the budget and trying to figure out if you need to cut back on things or if you can proceed as planned. A certain project that I worked on had an architectural feature that cost $30,000. We got partway through that project and scrapped it because we couldn't afford it, not if we wanted to maintain the quality of the rest of the project. And I know that, the school board, everyone goes through their budget with a fine-tooth comb, but I just wonder, who's going through the budget on these public works projects that are occurring in Cape Elizabeth? And again, I apologize for this because I'm coming after the fact and I'm venting, but when I drive through and I look at all those rocks, when I drive down to the dump and you've got 12 light poles leading to the public works building, which is a gorgeous building, no one can see it. So it's not really that it's built for aesthetic value for the town. I just look at all this other money that is being spent, and then you've got the school board that's begging and groveling for $45,000 here or whatever. And I just find it upsetting. And then again, taxes always get blamed, the increase in taxes, on the school board budget. Where about the increase in taxes for all of these extra things? Even the students are talking about the number of offices, the showers, the fitness room, and the police station. These are middle school students coming home and discussing this. And then you're going to tell them that they can't have freshman sports or they can't have certain programs in the high school because you can't afford extra teachers. I'm frustrated. I'm sure you know that. I'm waiting next for the town hall renovation. I understand there's talks about a park next door. I think the money needs to go to the schools. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
My name's Elaine Maloney. I live on 19 Stonegate Road, and I wanted to thank the town council for allowing public comment this evening, and I especially wanted to thank a lot of the supporters of the schools that have come out in support of the school budget tonight. I want to start out by questioning the town council and our community as to where they stand on education in Cape Elizabeth. As far as I know, Cape has offered one of the best educational values over the past two decades. It was a major factor in why I chose to move my family here. Other towns have continued to build upon their programs, and there now appears smaller and smaller gaps amongst the six or seven surrounding communities that we compare ourselves to. My fear lies in the state continuing to cut our funding, coupled with the town council who continues to cut and restrict our new initiatives, will undoubtedly fuel a declining school system over the next decade. Yes, even with or without the cuts that we've been talking about this evening, our schools are going to open in September, and our professionals will do the best they can. But this is not the kind of support our schools and our kids deserve for the long haul. The requested school budget increase of 5.3%, or even less when you add in the telephone and some of those other cuts that we found, represent an expense of less than a dollar per week increase in taxes on the average house in Cape. So again, I ask, where does this community stand in their willingness to pay that kind of an increase in our tax for our schools? And I believe the majority in our town would. I find that numerous surveys that I've seen support done in the interest of determining what taxpayers think are important continue to support the statement that Americans want to protect schools from budget cuts and truly believe that education should be recession-proof. I know firsthand that the school board is committed to providing the best possible education to our students in a fiscally responsible way. I believe we responded this way in our presentation and our request to the town council. In a year when we can least afford to step back because of a nearly $500,000 cut from the state, we are asked to keep our increase below even what our negotiated salary and benefit cost increases represent, and cut even further. I believe that the school board appropriately avoided cuts in programming, first because it directly affects the job we do with our students, and secondly because we have been able to cut in other areas at the expense of our capital improvement, our maintenance, and our energy savings. Consequently, we don't see that huge outpour in the newspapers or at the town meeting that some of the other towns are experiencing, such as South Portland and Portland. But what I do want to talk about is a little bit about what their community members are coming out to support because they want programs continued in their schools. Portland wanted to cut their lobbyist from a full-time position to a part-time position to save $25,000. Portland wanted to cut their elementary school string instrument program to the cost of $55,000. They wanted to cut their sex ed program at the grade school level for a savings of $39,000. They wanted to cut their gifted and talented program at the grade school level at $100,000. Articles in the papers have also discussed that they're thinking about eliminating their TV station at a cost of $73,000. And South Portland is looking at closing neighborhood schools. All of these things we don't even have them to cut. We made a conscious decision not to offer these programs in the past, and we've made a conscious decision to save money years ago by having one large elementary school instead of two small neighborhood schools that South Portland so adamantly wants to keep. When a community supports a local government that provides us with bountiful open space, protected wetlands, very limited business opportunities, brand new town buildings, we know that as a citizen there is a cost to pay. Is it to be at the expense of our schools, or is it to be paid with increased taxes? I, for one, am willing to pay with the tax increase. It does not put us out of line with other communities, and it would keep our school system simply treading water this year instead of increasing our programs. I also would like to challenge the town council to consider cutting one of their police cruisers that they replace every year, just as we cut a bus last year. I support increasing the revenues by charging at Fort Williams, and I know that is on your agenda for later on this evening. And I also want to remind the town council members how, when they had a hearing regarding the community services building, that there were several community members who came out and did not want you to sell the lot next to the town hall at a cost of $200,000. You listened to them, you heard them, and you changed your mind. But I also heard those community members saying, $200,000, what's that? You know, it's not that much money on the tax rate. Those were people who share the same feelings that we do about our schools. What happens next year is more of a concern to me, and I encourage our community members to spend the next year educating themselves on our town's budget, answering the question of where we want our resources to go, and finally taking action and letting our state government know how we feel about the education funding formula and the repercussions to our community. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Tech McCall. I live on 4 Avon Road, and the thing that brought me here this evening was I received this sheet in school. The teachers handed this out to us. The thing that caught my attention most was this part on the back of it. The school board identified potential cuts of $161,000, which will eliminate funding for freshman sports teams and all field trips. Especially the freshman sports teams, this irritated me, and that's why I'm here tonight. Freshman sports are a lot more important to me, and I'm sure to anybody here, than a pile of rocks costing $50,000. But you look over there, and then you look at the freshman sports teams, Well, which is more impressive? I personally, anybody who wants to argue with me, go right ahead.
Thank you very much.
Oops. I think this gentleman is next, and then you. Sorry, we've got a converging two-line system here.
My name's Ed O'Neill. I live at 28 Macaulay Road. And I'm very empathetic to everything I've heard here tonight from the other citizens that have walked up here. As a father and a grandfather, I can certainly empathize with the school situation. As somebody that just fell into that 30% that Mr. Lanza referred to earlier, I can empathize with his position as well. What I'm here for is to caution the council about the decisions that they've made. I hope that you don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. You're faced with some serious fiscal challenges, and I respect the difficulty that you find yourself in trying to resolve those issues. However, Cape Elizabeth is a beautiful town. Its residents take pride in the appearance of their properties, and in doing so, they maintain the values of those properties. One has only to ride around town just prior to the annual fall and spring pickups to look at brush and debris piled on the side of the road to appreciate how the residents depend on this basic service that they've enjoyed and paid for in their tax bill for many, many years. You can ride around Cape Elizabeth and enjoy its beauty without encountering unsightly piles of clutter that pose a disposal challenge to property owners because of logistical problems. The proposal to eliminate the spring-heavy pickup defies logic, because spring is the time when we traditionally have lots of down limbs and winter from winter ice and snowstorms, this year excepted. And people do their spring cleanups that include lots of items that can't be put into the trunk of their cars or the interior of an expensive van or SUV. Depending on whom you talk to about this proposal, it will save either $15,000 or $20,000 annually. There are approximately 4,229 taxable properties in Cape Elizabeth, of which about 3,500 are single-family residences. The average current single-family residence in the town is valued at $196,400. In doing the math on this proposal, it appears that the actual impact on the average single-family residence annual tax assessment is a mere $5, or 3 cents a thousand. I think you would have a very difficult time finding a taxpayer who doesn't think that this wonderful service the town supplies is worth $5, particularly if you tell them that if this proposal passes, they'll have to pay $10 per load to take their pickup truck to the dump and get rid of the stuff that you saved them $5 annually on. Please reconsider this proposal. It's not good for the taxpayers. And I believe it's their money and their interests that must be considered ahead of any other agenda. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you very much, sir. You're on.
Good evening. I'm Kathy Perkins. I live at 415 Mitchell Road. I just have a very brief comment. I have been watching the budget process for a number of years, and have been reading the paper and understand that it's a difficult time for everybody in Maine and southern Maine. But I'm not sure that, you know, as I listen to people talk about, you know, whether or not they're going to be able to stay in their homes or be able to afford to live in our town, I'm not sure that it's really about Cape Elizabeth. I think it's about the rising cost of living in Maine. Because if you read in the paper, it's really, I think, unfair the way money is raised and spent in Maine, and our government is somewhat lopsided, you know, with the two Maines. But and I just wanted to respond to somebody, one of the gentlemen's comments about teachers' pay, and sort of how we compare to other towns. And I know, you know, we're very different from Falmouth and we're very different from Scarborough, But we're a lot like, you know, we're a small town. A lot of times we're compared to places like Yarmouth. But in the 2002-2003 proposed school budget expenditures, we, out of the seven schools compared, which are all sort of more affluent southern Maine towns, we are 7 out of 7 lowest on the list. Yarmouth having an increase in their spending of 16.4, Cape Elizabeth 5.34. Our costs, which are a couple years old, our cost of per pupil operating cost, out of, we're 6 out of 9, being kind of a little bit below average. And the one that I think we should appreciate maybe the most, or look at the most, is our teacher. And I know that recently our teachers were given a bigger increase to sort of get back up to the median. But unfortunately, our teachers are 6 out of 6. Yarmouth, Cumberland, Freeport, Falmouth, Scarborough, and Cape Elizabeth were the lowest. So I think that, you know, it's important to sort of see where we sit with people that are, you know, we're not the same as all the other schools, but I think that we probably are considered one of the best, if not the best, in Southern Maine. And I think we do a lot, but maybe not as much as some of the other schools. And I also want to say that I've been on a few committees, I've been to a few budget meetings, and a lot of time and effort gets put into the town budget, the school budget, you know, community centers, police stations, school buildings, and I must say I think a lot of real, really positive, hard, long, you know, excruciating work goes into these projects. And for everybody in the town, I think that we're all doing pretty much the best that we can. But I think that the school shouldn't be cut off at 4%. I think that we need to take a look at really what we're, you know, what the big consequence is. So at any rate, thanks.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Anyone else? Nope. Everyone stands up at once. Whoop. Oh, some people are, maybe people are leaving. I don't know. Please, step forward.
My name is Grace McKenzie, and I live at 10 Longfellow Drive. I really don't have much to say except the fact, like, that my dad moved us here a couple years ago, and he moved us here mainly because of the schools, and I just wanted to say that I really love my school, and I love the teachers, and I don't want any of them to get cut just because the police station has to have, well, they have, like, 2 cops on duty, and the police station is really nice, and it's nice to have, but I don't think we need that much, and that's what I wanted to say. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Hi.
Hello.
My name is Erin Grady Gallant, and I live at 52 Columbus Road. And I'm not prepared, but I am prepared to just say that I graduated from Cape Elizabeth. The schools are our most important resource besides our land and our children. And I think it's very important that if cuts are made, that they're not made at the school level. I have an 8th grader and a 7th grader, and the cutting of freshman sports is something that I'm upset about, because I know that you look at the paper and you see, what do we have for our kids to do around town? Nothing. And you have a panel on teenage drinking and all these other things, and then you take away one thing that maybe some of these kids wouldn't make a JV team, but they'll make a freshman team, and if they don't get that opportunity, by the time they're a sophomore or a junior, it may be too late. They will have found something else to do, and it might not be the best thing for them. I know in the middle school this year, in 8th grade, the boys, I believe there were 31 boys that tried out for baseball, so that there are 2 8th grade teams. And out of those 31, how many are going to make the JV team next year if there's not a freshman team? Probably maybe a third of them. As a taxpayer and a parent, I don't mind paying more taxes if I can continue with the services that we have. I was amazed reading this green sheet that I'm a real estate broker, and I'm always promoting how we pay our teachers better and our schools are so much better, and The people in Cape don't mind putting money back into their schools because they recognize the importance of it. And then I read this, and it was like a very rude awakening that we're not the best, or at least it doesn't look like that from here. And as far as taxes, I can't remember the last time I sold a house that wasn't at least 70% valuated. At least 30, they got at least 30% more than what they've been taxed at for the last 10 years. So our property values are high. People move to this town and pay top dollar because of our schools, and it's important that we don't follow some of the other towns locally that have taken cuts in the schools and had people move out in a mass exodus. So I know everybody's working hard for this. I know it's a hard job, but don't cut our schools, please. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Mr. Rowe.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My name is Jim Rowe, and I live at 127 Oakhurst Road. I happen to be a member of the Cape Elizabeth School Board, but as you know, I've chosen a rather singular path regarding this budget issue. As you know, I was the only dissenting vote on that body with regard to the school department's initial proposed budget. I dissented for two reasons. First, to call people's attention to the inequity of Maine's school funding formula and what it has done to Cape Elizabeth. And second, I voted against the budget because I chose not to participate in what the budget does to the property taxpayers of Cape Elizabeth, particularly those who are living on modest and fixed means. I stand by my vote on April 9th on both counts, but the fiscal and economic landscapes have changed a little since then, to the tune of either $191,000 or $161,000, depending on whose point of view you assume. I stand before you tonight to ask that you please give favorable consideration to the proposed school budget as revised, and which calls for an increase of 4.2% from the current year's budget. While there's precious little in this whole budget process this year that has seemed fair or easy, I think the revised proposal does inject a significant degree of equity into the matter. Please appreciate my posture both as someone who cares a great deal about the welfare of our school system and also as someone who, having spent my entire life here, appreciates the needs of that portion of our citizenry that is hurting from prevailing economic and fiscal conditions. I think the thing that has really prompted me to speak here tonight is that as of the middle of last week, there is now an increasing likelihood that the state may not, in fact, be done with its rape of the Cape Elizabeth school system. That scares me, and I hope it scares us all. I'd like to see a more substantial and unified attack on this problem in Augusta. We're all in this budget mess together. This is a time when we all have to be willing to look beyond our own special interests, to pull together, and to see and appreciate each other's positions, and to agree upon a path, if not the most beneficial, is the least damaging to our town and its schools. The school budget proposal as revised is fair, reasonable, and responsible under the current conditions because it clearly demonstrates that the funding formula has hurt our school district and not just the property taxpayers of Cape Elizabeth. Like South Portland, we now have to have fuel to fire our own argument against the formula, because we will not be as good a school system under this budget as we are today. This revised budget also more evenly balances the property tax burden between the schools and our other municipal services. Although it falls short of the $191,000 the council wanted the school department to find, the revised budget does represent the most sincere attempt at what I consider to be true fiscal responsibility in my 3 years on the school board. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Madam Chair, members of the council, my name is John Delahanty. I'm a resident of 11 Manor Way, and I stand here not really prepared because a lot of these figures I've seen for the first time, but I'm here primarily because just a few days ago, I came up to the meeting of the Cape Coalition to talk about the underage substance abuse issues here in this town, and I'm very concerned with what I heard that evening as to what's going on with our youth, And I am very concerned this evening when I see the budget cutting out programs for you. And I should admit that I am here in a somewhat role of trying to protect what my children participate in, because I have two children in the eighth grade going on in that bubble. I guess part of the problem is that we had twins, so we increased the bubble. But they are going into the ninth grade, and to see the freshman athletic budget being cut is of concern, especially based upon what I heard from the youth that attended the meeting just last week. I heard the Madam Chair talk about architectural fees in the budget. I don't know what those are. We've certainly heard a lot of comment about the architectural fees or the potential architectural excesses of $50,000 worth of stone in the town garage at the transfer station, but those are already built. We can't go back there. But I do get concerned when I have heard, maybe incorrectly, but that I did note on one of the sheets this evening that there's an increase in enrollment in the high school, therefore there's a need for increased staff and increased dollars. I also understand there's a decrease in enrollment at the middle school, but, you know, there's no decrease in money or decrease in staff. Now, maybe that can't be done. I don't know. But I'm looking for $8,000 for freshman athletics. I understand that some of the increase at the high school is to have two study hall monitors rather than have teachers do it. I think for the sake of our children, keeping the study hall monitors being the present staff rather than hiring two additional ed techs is very important for our youth. I would rather put our youth programs at the freshman level before hiring two ed techs, if in fact that is. It's just a comment I've heard around, maybe totally not accurate, and I apologize if it isn't. I understand that holding the budget, creating budgets during difficult economic times is a very tough job, and I wouldn't want to be in your position. I wouldn't want to be in the position of the school board. But, you know, I understand there are negotiated increases that have to be included in the budget. There are substantial increases, I'm sure, in insurance costs. I'm very well aware of the slashing that takes place for the communities such as Cape Elizabeth, the slashing that takes place in Augusta to the educational budget. It is totally unfair the way that is calculated. But to cut the freshman athletic program for what I understand is the cost of $8,000, I would sincerely hope that during this process that those monies could be found. Certainly selfish on my part, because I have two children going into the ninth grade, but I guess hearing about architectural fees or freezes, I get a little concerned, as well as understanding about a couple of ed techs to monitor study halls. I appreciate everything that's been done. I know it's very difficult. I wish you all the best, and I really hope that our school systems can continue to do the great job that they do, and I urge you to support them. I want to support them. As I said, I guess I'm being selfish here tonight for that $8,000. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Yes, sir.
My name is Ed Macklin. I live at 981 Shore Road. And I'm going to be plain and simple. I'm from South Portland. I'm a former athlete from South Portland. As a parent now, and as a child of retired parents, I feel we have two responsibilities. We have a responsibility to the people who are retired, who continue to want to live here, but mostly have a responsibility to my children and all the children in the neighborhood. If we cut programs of any type that affect children, then maybe we'll have a real use for the police station for a change. so, I think as a parent, and as we're all parents here, none of these kids want to listen about an architectural fee, about how gorgeous this building is, about a fiscal this, a fiscal that. The bottom line is, it's our responsibility to educate and take care of our children, plain and simple. We have to find a way to do it. Maybe as a parent, we revisit a fee user, a user fee type of system. We have to revisit maybe raising a one-time tax fee. But I just feel that as a true responsible citizen, we cannot turn our back on our children, because my parents never turned their back on me. And I'm sure without a proper education, none of us would be here, and none of us would be enjoying the financial success that we have without a proper education. And an education is not only schooling, but it's also the extracurricular activities that keep our kids off the street. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Somebody else?
Good evening. My name is Trish Brigham. I live at 34 Rockcrest Drive. And I want to thank the town council and the school board. I've sort of sat in on a few meetings, and I empathize with the difficulty facing both the school board and the town council. However, I will try not to repeat some of the eloquent comments that were made before me. I first want to say, I guess my bottom line is that I supported the original school budget as it was presented to you. I thought it was extremely lean, in fact, too much so. I have three children, two of whom are in the school system, one who is entering, and I'm in there quite a bit. In fact, my fourth grade son is in a class whose size exceeds the guidelines. So for as many classes that might be under, there are some that are over. The one thing I think that's been missing from this discussion is the word investment. We look at the school budget and it's a cost. I've seen justifications for the cost of the police department and other municipal buildings and projects as an investment for the community. We haven't used the word investment in analyzing the budget that we're discussing. It's cost. What are we going to keep the cost to? We're investing in the quality of life that we have in this community. And there's a cost to that. There's a cost to the trail system. There's a cost to a primarily residential community. I am willing to pay higher taxes to support that quality of life. And I think education is valued in this community, and I think that is truly an aspect to the quality of life that brings many people to Cape Elizabeth and to remain here. So I guess I would leave you with the thought to please keep in mind the long term and not just here and now. And I think that we can be overly fiscally conservative. I think if you do look at some of the charts and how our teachers are compensated, where we stand in per pupil spending, I have seen some analyses done, not necessarily in Maine, but in other areas where the success of the school districts actually parallels per pupil spending. And right now, our per pupil spending puts us in the middle of the pack, not at the top of the elite heap, where I think we would like to think that we could be. So I think we've been very fiscally conservative. I would try to urge you not to be overly so this year, in spite of the difficult environment we find ourselves in. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Who's next?
My name is Jim Spaulding. I'm from 5 Montgomery Terrace. Excuse me. Or as I'm known around Cape Elizabeth High School, I'm Aaron and Jamie's dad. I'm not Jim Spaulding. My question is if we could get a clarification from the school board to the town council about how fees are charged at athletic events. For those of you, and it appears that there are a lot of incoming freshman parents here, it's not about the freshman teams, or rather the sophomores, juniors, and seniors that won't be playing because the better than average freshman athletes will be playing. So there'll be a lot of great students that want to continue to play sports that will no longer be able to play sports. So it's more that than it is just freshmen not playing. There'll be a lot of average students on the street. But my question is this, and perhaps this is more for the school board if we could find out. Excuse me, basketball, there is a charge to games. It is my understanding that there is no charge for soccer or lacrosse or other sports. I will eat the hat if you can't make $8,000 passing the hat at those games at Cape Elizabeth. I think there's an inequity where the school system has made a lot of money off from basketball in the past years at Cape, and yet the boosters clubs have taken the money on some of the other sports. And it's time to clarify that and put that money back into the system. Thanks.
Thank you very much. More people? More public comment? Going once? No? Okay. You're coming. Okay.
Coming.
Yes. Okay, just checking. People are sort of moving around in the back. I'm not clear on who's going where.
My name is Chris Cast. My family is at 12 Perfutic Drive. And I am guilty of never attending one of these meetings. I'm guilty of never attending a budget meeting. I'm also guilty of watching two children go through the school system being cared for, nurtured, and growing. I'm guilty of hearing them say things that they hear on the bus about, they're not going to be any field trips next year. They're going to cut freshman athletics. I'm guilty of feeling really sad about that. Because we are indirectly, or quite directly, impacting their day-to-day life through the debates that we're having here right now. The investment, beautiful word, that we make and continue to make in the school system and in our children is invaluable because it protects a precious asset. It also supports the reason why there's an infusion of young people and young families into this town. So I support, and I encourage the town council to support, any increase in spending that we need to have in order to continue to strengthen the investment in our children. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Madam Chairperson. My name is Ed McCall, and I see it says chairman out in front of you, but...
You can call me...
Maybe...
You can even call me chair.
Well, I mean...
It's a piece of furniture, but...
I'll pony up the dough to get an appropriate placard for you.
Thank you.
4 Avon Road. Well, I've lived there for 19 years, and for the first 11, we paid taxes, didn't have any kids in the schools. And when my wife said, you think we should hold our son back a year later to start kindergarten, I said, you got to be kidding me. We've been paying these taxes forever. We're gonna start to get the free service next year. And since then, as I think most parents in Cape Elizabeth do, we've tried to stress to our kids how important their education is, that it's the most important thing that they're doing, that they're learning not just the fundamentals of English and mathematics, but also how to get along with other kids in the schools, how to be part of the community. And we've been blessed to have kids that throughout the system have always had great teachers, they've always had great experiences, they've always had a school system that seemed to care as much as we did about their future and seemed to let them know how important their education is. And I think, frankly, the last gentleman who spoke triggered this thought in my mind, and I hadn't planned to say anything because I've just agreed with so many people that already went ahead of me. But I think that we need to have this council as the spokespeople for our town send a message to all the kids who are here, who are watching on TV, and who are going to follow this debate and the resolution of this issue, that we all know how important they are and how important their education is in all of its components. We have the opportunity to have a tremendous failing here and to suggest to our kids that bricks and mortar that are appealing to the eye are more important than their education and more important than their future. And if we fail that test, it will be a very, very unhappy day. And this has been a great town for us for 19 years. I, too, have never come to a town council meeting. And I urge the town council not to send the wrong message to our kids. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Mom. My name's Denise Mitchell. I live at 27 Brentwood Road. And I grew up in Maine, and I moved away for college and recently moved back because I felt it important to my 4 and 7-year-old to grow up in an area where people look after their own. And I also worked as a nurse, and I worked with troubled teens, and I worked with kids on the street. And I think that I can show you study after study after study that shows that children that are not involved in school activities and are their interests sparked within the school system, they'll find interests elsewhere. Hence, areas that don't have good after-school programs, there's an increase in teenage pregnancy, there's an increase in drug use, et cetera, et cetera. Everybody has seen those studies. And so I just think that as a community, that there isn't a lot for kids to do if they're not in school. There's, you know, they have to drive to go anywhere. I think that we really need to appreciate how important it is to provide funds so that, again, we don't have to use the police station like that gentleman had said. We don't have to use our ambulances because we have our kids out on the roads instead of at school. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anybody else?
Thank you. I see a lot of, my name is Jim Barrett. I live at 57 Zeb Cove Road. I grew up in Cape, proud to be home in Cape. Mike's done some terrific things in my limited exposure to him. I see some familiar teachers and administrators here. I'm really proud to be part of this community. Let me say my background is finance, corporate finance. I was chief financial officer of a $13 billion bank. I'm used to the nausea budget process. I'm also used to and have spent a lot of my career with highly competent finance staff working for and around me. I think a lot of our administrators are brilliant administrators. They're not geared up to be finance guys. I'd like to have our administrators spending their sleepless nights and our teachers spending their sleepless nights worrying about how does Cape Elizabeth become the vision that they've set for this school in their strategic plan. That is the most accomplishing school that we can possibly be. Boy, Frank, I've known Frank Petendro since I was a little guy. I grew up with Frank's daughter graduated in my class. I think Cape Elizabeth was probably 80% senior citizens then. It's only 30 now. It seems like a surprise. Frank, you referenced 85% of the school budget. I think on a net, I'm just beginning to get involved in these numbers, my friends. Let me tell you why I care. My property taxes are going from $15,000 this year to over $35,000. I'm not asking anybody to feel sorry for me. The world's been good to me. I've gotten a lot done in my career. I feel good about what my contribution has been to date to the injecting resources into the building community. I think maybe I'm in a pretty much a unique position to see what I can do to help maybe the school administration, help maybe the town council, sort of be like a free consultant to come in and look at concepts with you guys like cost-benefit analysis, really rigorous cost-benefit analysis on everything we're doing. I read last year, I think in the Cape Courier, some stuff about G. Fort Williams, a beautiful park, everybody should have free access. I completely agree with that, as long as it's revenue neutral to the town when the town's crunched for what I consider to be absolutely core school programs. I mean, my words may not be right, you guys talk about a program, I think that means curriculum. I think freshman sports is huge. Freshman sports is sociology 101. I don't think you can take that out of the school program without just thinking about what else can we just totally eviscerate. I mean, I challenge school administration and you teachers, keep caring about what you're doing, work your hardest, do your best, keep critical evaluation going of teachers that aren't getting it done. Teachers aren't getting it done and we're paying them $28,000 a year. They're costing us three times that in productivity, in administration tie-up, in parent tie-up, in ineffective learning. That's a big challenge for you guys. I'd like to see you staying up at night, and I know you are, staying up at night worrying about that instead of, gee, can we do something other than eliminate freshman sports? I'm sorry for my kind of rambly comments. I'm sorry for not being comfortable with the forum and not being prepared. I'm used to knowing my stuff, and I want to apologize for not being involved in a detailed level on the budget. The only reason I reference my personal taxes is I'm telling you, as a taxpayer, I care a lot about what we're doing in here. I have four young kids in the school. Since we came back here in 1998, we've had some spectacular teachers. We've had some teachers that I think weren't the best, onesie, twosie, here and there. We've had absolutely brilliant, stunningly brilliant, administrative response to the concerns we've raised when we have. I think we've done an outstanding job. I had some concerns about the superintendent process. Some of you may remember me as the, you know, the young guy who had a lot to say, and who the hell's he to tell us what he thinks? Well, I think Mr. Forsell is doing a brilliant job. I had a list of five or six things I thought when I started looking at the program before he was here. Going, where's our strategic plan for the school? We don't have one. What's the vision of this place? You know, sometimes whether it's corporate America, whether it's a law firm, you know, whether it's a finance unit or whether it's a school administration, you kind of need somebody saying, go on that way. And everybody that has a different view can kind of fall into that line. I would suggest, if you just give me another minute or so, I'll shut up. But I would suggest that this town needs you guys as the elected leaders to go, and Mike McGovern's leadership as well, going, here's where we're going. It hurts right now. It's painful. Here's where we're going. We're going to continue to push to have this school system be the best it could possibly be. If our school administrators think they need that extra $161,000, I'm tempted. I'm not going to. But I'm tempted to say, let me write the check this year. But God darn it, let's fix it for next year. Let me talk to you, if I could, just briefly. I don't know even what my appropriate forum is. We've got a young guy, Matthew, I forget his last name, running our assessor's office. I've just begun to talk to him since I just got a letter telling me that my new beautiful home, dream home, always wanted to build it, is now being valued by the town, assessed by the town, at what it costs to build it. When I know of a $4 million before change order house that was built last year that's assessed at $1.8 million. Now, if you follow my math, why isn't that assessed at $4 million? I don't get that. You take 2%, that's, you know, that's another $80,000. Well, let's pause and think though, Jim. If we're gonna assess that guy at $4 million and charge him 2.2%, he's paying $90,000 a year. Well, if he's 60, Frank, and he's about 60, some of you may know who I'm talking about, he should give the town his money if he's gonna live to be 85 and wants to stay in that house. He should give the town his house. He's going to save the value of that house just not paying taxes for the next 25 years. So I think, I don't know how to fix that. To me, it seems, if you own a house in Cape Elizabeth, whether or not you have kids, you got to be paying a base unit for the police, for the dump, town hall, for this broadcast, for the whole program. It seems to me there ought to be that core unit. And then those of us fortunate enough to have the wherewithal and the willingness to deploy significant assets into real estate, maybe there ought to be a heavy levy for that. But it sure seems to me like taking my friend I'm referencing to full replacement value is, and then saying, okay, 2.2%, that amounts to nothing short of confiscation, in my opinion. I'm on the ocean. I'm advised that probably my land value is going up another $500,000 next year. Well, that's really neat. So my taxes are going to go from mid-30s to mid-40s. So I guess what I kind of sit back, and I'm not asking anybody to feel sorry for me. Like I said, the world's been good to me, and I want to do my share. But I think I would like to ask you, Mike, and maybe you and I can, this is not the forum, we can spend some other time with it, but I'd like to ask the town council to really think through, what are we doing with assessment? Because I can, if the reason for my house today being valued at what it costs to build it is that it's done, as has been discussed with me, I can point to numerous houses built in the last 1, 2, 3, and 4 years that are at 50% of what they cost to build. And I don't understand that. Am I doing something wrong? Is it that, you know, do I need to wear more expensive clothes, hire a different law firm to represent me and things like this? I'm not sure what the deal is. But I feel like I'm personally paying for that stonework over at the police station. And I don't think that's right. Let me, if I could, I'm going to wrap up my comments. I've got 4 or 5 key points I want to make. I want to thank you for indulging me a little bit of time to share some views from somebody who grew up here and thinks the school system's great. By the way, my wife and I are saying, maybe we should go back to La Jolla, just have a look at the ocean and maybe just invest a couple $1 million and not be so heavily invested here. But I do have some points I wanted to talk about. Let me try to stay on point and just blitz through them if you further indulge me. If it wasn't clear, I think you guys should have every penny you need to run the programs you think are appropriate for the school, because I think you're doing a great job. Cape Elizabeth's realty values are like double South Portland and Gorham and Gray. I mean, those are much better places to retire, it seems to me. You can still see your friends and play cards and play golf with Papudic without a big drive. If you don't want to pay the freight that's associated with having the best schools in the state, this is a very difficult place to live, even if you've been here your whole life. Even if you don't like paying the oceanfront freight, if you happen to be there. But it seems to me the socioeconomic strata that's here is one of very accomplishing people. I know guys lobstering making $100,000 a year. I know guys installing plumbing fixtures making $100,000 a year here. The guys up in Denmark installing plumbing fixtures are drinking half of the $30,000 a year they're making. So, and I don't mean that to be an overgeneralization, but there's a lot of very accomplishing peoples at all levels in socioeconomic strata here in Cape Elizabeth. Guys are out to get stuff done. The spectacular landscape here, it's a beautiful place to live. But I share Aaron's comment. I think the biggest reason that people want to live here is at least the perception that we've got first-rate schools and total community support for that. I share some of the views we've heard tonight, point number two, that there's been really a tremendous amount spent on public buildings. I just moved here when some of that talk was going on. I think kind of the council supported what was and approved plans and built what was there, so did the community. It's sort of hard to say, geez, Mike, why'd you let that happen? A lot more people needed to object, say, why don't we cut the size of those buildings in half? Why do we need covered parking for trucks, et cetera, before they were built, not after they were built. But I think that the lesson that I hear rumbling all over town, everywhere I go in the last 3 weeks, is, not again. So I just challenge you all to really think about what we're doing the next time we want to start adding to infrastructure over here in buildings. I really think that we need to fix the assessment base. The people at Cross Hill should not be paying for lesser homes more money in taxes than the people in Stonegate, homes that were built 8 and 10 years ago. That's not right. I know that's part of the reassessment, but I just want to say I can give you a list of 10 homes right now that are at half of their assessment base. If we just jack those up like Jim Barrett's house to what would it cost to build it today, we fix this year's tax problem without changing the tax. We fixed $160,000, certainly. And I really think we ought to spend Matthew's next week, Mike, on thinking about that process alone. I'd like to, again, suggest rigorous cost-benefit analysis and zero-based budgeting on all significant aspects of the budget. I don't know if it's ever been done. Maybe Mike lives that. Maybe the school lives that. But really think about cost-benefit. So that is, what does it cost us, and what are we as a community, as a town, getting out of it? And I use cost here interchangeably with the word investment. But community services is a net cost. Somebody might think absolutely should be. I think that that should be self-sustaining. Let me just blitz through these quickly. Soccer fields, I know of two clubs that are using some of our town fields that we fought so hard to get for as a town and as a soccer community. Well, that's great. Let's charge a modest rent. Let them help pay for mowing them and watering them. I think Fort Williams should be a self-sustaining thing. Cape residents, stickered, come on in for free. Buses, you know, get out your $25 cleanup fee, because we're going to empty the trash buckets a lot more.
We're going to have to pick up trash around the place, and please, you know, use the guest facility. Maybe we should have some kind of food thing. If the guy, one of our few commercial successes in Cape Elizabeth out at the Lobster Shack, he probably has a $2 million, I'm probably offending someone with this, but probably has a $2 million shack down on in La Jolla somewhere, too. But why can't the town have a successful food venture? Not inside a lighthouse, maybe up top of the hill somewhere. Why can't we sell our own lobster rolls up there and make $500,000 a year free and clear? And dump that back into the kitty. And maybe most of you find that abhorrent. I'm just thinking, it's a beautiful park, it's a beautiful amenity, it's a heck of a thing for a town to sustain by itself when the greater Portland community and tour buses are using it hard. Somebody said something about keep one of the patrol cars longer. They're beautiful cars. I think, to some extent, it's been comforting to me that I don't hear anybody blaming Mike or town council or police or anybody else. Everybody wants to grouse about the buildings. I mean, we've built some beautiful buildings that are going to be here for 50 years, I think. I really wonder about what's up at the dump, but the police station's absolutely stunningly beautiful. The richest community on the west side of Los Angeles would be proud to say, look what we did for our public servants. I think our police force is great. I do. I've met most of them individually. I think they're terrific guys. They're family guys. They're really neat people. I think that we can stay in our police cars. Do cost-benefit analysis. We'll be keeping those cars for 2 or 3 years, especially if we don't have them out on patrol writing tickets to non-Cape Elizabeth residents more aggressively and controlling speed around here.
Mr. Barron, if you could...
I'm sorry, I'm almost done. I'm not even trying to be funny. These are the things keeping me up at night.
These are good ideas, just in the interest of everyone else who's out here waiting.
I think we should be looking really hard. We have the limited acreage and facility to build new homes here. I think they should be paying some heavy-duty freight with their future implications for the schools. That we've got world-class snow removal and ice control. I'm glad that trucks that we pack salt and sand into have got covered parking to keep them out of UV damage, I guess. But I really would question whether we need to spend maybe some of the super resources we have on that sort of airport-level ice-free and snow-free facility of roadways we have here in Cape Elizabeth. Let me wrap up my comments again, thanking the school for everything you guys are doing. I think you're doing a terrific job. Let me know what I can do to help. Please call me. I'll help you review finance stuff. My last comment is I really would like you guys to think about seeing if anybody is interested in serving on a citizen finance review committee, just sort of independent, not worried about getting reelected to the high-paying jobs you guys hold at town council. Not worrying about running for school board and all of that incredible overtime comp that you guys get for doing that. But really just come in and look at stuff cold with you and evaluate stuff with a numbers hat on. I would love the opportunity to be part of that. I think I can muster 3 or 4 other people with similar backgrounds to do that as well. Just have a totally cold review. And it's obviously too late for this year, but maybe we can think about that next year. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. Is there anyone else who would like to speak?
Good evening. My name is Elaine Fallander.
Thank you.
And I live at 16 Mayor's Hollow Lane, and I have just a couple of very brief comments. I think that it's particularly important in times of economic difficulty to maintain our school funding. I think we have wonderful schools. They've certainly served my family well, and I'm sure they will continue to do so. But I think there are a number of ways in which we can improve our schools. I heard the discussion of some of the programs that Portland has and South Portland has that we don't have. I think we should have some of those programs. I understand that those programs are expensive, but they're not a 1 or a 2 year shot. If we're really going to continue to improve our schools, we have to be committed to continuing to invest in the kinds of additional programming that will allow our schools to improve, to provide more opportunities for children at all of the different academic levels, to provide athletic and after-school opportunities. But we have to be willing to do it every single year, and not to say this year we'll tread water, or this year we'll give up on some of those particular programs. I think we have to have a long-term and a sustained commitment to our schools. And I think we need to keep that in mind, especially now. More money doesn't mean better programming. And I think we have to also keep that in mind and always make sure that the money that's being spent is being spent wisely. But I think many of us, and I speak certainly for myself, are willing to make that kind of investment, and it's particularly important to remember that now. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else? And going once, going twice. Okay. I think we're done with the public comment. Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry, didn't see you up there in the back. Come on forward. Is there anybody else who's thinking of it? If they could at least sort of move over to that side of the room, that would be helpful.
I am a little disorganized because I've crossed things out trying not to repeat things.
If you could just identify yourself.
Oh, sorry. Jennifer DeSena, 4 Ivy Road. I'm also a member of the school board. One thing that I want to just mention in terms of cuts, it's never been the intent of the school board to eliminate freshman sports. It's to eliminate the funding that we provide for freshman sports, which means that if those programs are to continue, then we need to find alternative ways of funding them, whether that's through booster groups or if we were able to save money through transportation costs or whatever. I would like to sort of go over some of the things that Tom mentioned earlier, perhaps in a smidgen more depth for my own personal satisfaction. When we were instructed to use similar restraint by the council sort of justified its increase of, well, for lack of a better term, 2.42. We have different rates versus expenditures and whatever, but by using salaries and benefits of their 51 full-time employees, at least that was the case in the year 2000. According to the website. The school department, using that same logic for its 246 full-time employees, more than five times what the town employs, using just salary, contracted salaries and benefits, for which right now we have no control over, increases our budget 4.2%. Mandated special ed increases account for another 0.9%. That's a total of 5.1%, and we haven't touched anything else in the budget. Overall, our operating budget is down over $16,000. Now, the town, in its rationale, also takes out the county budget so that its increase is lower because they have no control over the county budget. Now, if you do that, you go from a 2.26% tax rate for town services and include the county budget, over which you have no control, which I realize, your rate goes up to 4.8%. Now, the school budget, conversely, even at the 5.34, goes from 5.82%, but if we get to deduct the cost, and it's, you can't really do this because it's not an expenditure, it's a lack of revenue, I realize that, but trying to compare apples to apples, if we take out our loss of subsidy over which we have no control, our budget is up 3.48%. Now, I understand, let's see, where else have I got here? I know that the town understands that its role is not to tell the school board where to cut money. But it gives me pause this evening when you continue to suggest areas that you don't think we need to spend money in. Now, I I don't mean to be disrespectful, but we rely on our experts to tell us what needs replacing and what doesn't. The issue with the freezer, we have been told for years we need to do something with that freezer, okay? We rely on our experts to tell us this isn't going to last any longer. Now, I bet that there's not one of you up here that knows that that's the original freezer that was in the high school. It's 35 years old. It's leaking water now, okay? We pulled it out of last year's budget. It's an accident waiting to happen. If we have to, if the compressor goes, we have to put another one on for $6,000, and it would have to go on the roof. If the freezer goes, we can't put that in while school's in session, so that means we have to move all the food out of the freezer in the high school, bring it up to the middle school, hire somebody to do that. It's just not a good use of tax dollars. And the last thing I guess I would like to mention at this point is I would really submit that the council be satisfied with an increase of what would ultimately be 4.7% in the school budget. And that is if we take the $33,000 in energy and phone savings, which, by the way, were not known to the school board when they approved the original budget of 5.34, but were known when we presented our budget to you when that was discussed. And if we technically took the $60,000 out for the bus, which even though it has to be listed as an expenditure, really is not an expenditure, that's $93,000 right there without doing anything really to what is the rest of our budget. It drops our budget increase essentially, although it is moving figures around, to 4.7%, which is the lowest it's been in 3 years. I would also just like to end on the note that I spent some time counting all the children and parents in the student directory this year. Now, you don't have to be listed in the student directory, and there are 36 kids who aren't, and I assume their parents aren't as well. Counting all those kids and using the census from the year 2000 in the town, 41% of the town's population is either a parent or a student, K through 12. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Susan Steinman. I live at 10 Woodcrest Road. We moved here 11 years ago from the West Coast, walked into a realtor's office in Portland, and asked that realtor to direct us to the best schools in the area. That was basically it. Where are the schools? I don't think we're alone in that. 3 years ago, I had the privilege of serving on the Future Direction Committee. The charge of that committee was to put together a long-range plan, something that this town had not done, to decide where we want to be, what we want to be doing, and set a direction for us to follow. Very important work, wonderful work, inspiring, exciting. Out of that would come a K through 12 curriculum. We would be doing local assessments. What kind of job are we doing? Are we doing it at the level we should be doing it at? Is anybody falling through the cracks? Where can we get better? What are our measures? Are they just what kids go to good colleges? What about the kids that aren't right at the top, who really aren't getting their tax dollars worth out of our education at this point? What about climate? We know there's backbiting in that middle school. It's unfortunate. We could do a better job than we're doing. And I thought it was exciting. I thought it was great work. So I ran for school committee. I did not expect to be talking about freezers. And I did not expect to be getting hung up on class size. And when I look at it, the distance between where we are now at $161,000 increase in expenses versus $191,000 is $50 for the $200,000 household. The $200,000, we are $50 apart. I think we're hemorrhaging energy. I think morale is great in the schools. I think the administrators are doing a terrific job. I think teachers are excited about where they're working. I think kids like coming to school.
This is important, and I think right now to be hemorrhaging energy and enthusiasm and creative talent over $50 on a household is ridiculous waste of energy. If we put our minds and our energy in this room together to make this school system one of the best it can be in the country, we would all be more proud. Our real estate values would all go up. We would all win. And we're bickering over dollars. Again, I think it goes back to cost versus investment. And I think we need to get forward thinking again. I don't think we can afford to be doing this. We've got a new principal at the high school, wonderful, talented, visionary human being who has been sidetracked for weeks pulling together data on budget. What are we looking for here? I think it's ever important that we keep our eyes on the prize. Where do we want to be? How are we going to get there? What do we need to do to get there? And let's not get distracted. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hi, good evening. My name is Julie Boski. I live at 19 Park Circle, and I'll be very brief given the lateness of the hour. I guess in listening to everyone this evening, I really sympathize and agree with a lot of the comments that I've heard from parents in the community. It seems in listening to the budget process this year and in years past that we're going to be in this situation every year for years to come until something changes, and I'm just listening and wondering, what will be different for you next year when we're in this situation? What will be different in 2 years and 3 years? We'll be having the same discussion. And when I think about the resources that we have in our community, we all know that we don't have any commerce here. We don't have any Walmarts to support us. I wonder about Fort Williams, and I know that that's what the parents all sit and discuss during, you know, the Little League games. We all wonder. We seem to be sitting on an incredibly beautiful resource, and I guess I know I see that as an item on your agenda for, well, I don't know, it at some point. But I just wonder if that's not something that we can consider as a source of revenue, given that we seem to have so very little as an option in town. Thanks.
Thank you very much. More? Yes, please come forward. Mr. Antwell,
here. This is a different perspective for me, this angle rather than up there. I'm George Entwistle from 2 Avon Road, and I suppose I should also disclose that I am the chairman of the school board. I'll use Susan's terminology. I've hemorrhaged enough energy about this budget, but I have a few things to say, mostly because I'm a stickler for accuracy and for process. If you all, those of you who are left, we get a lot of people with kids in school-age children, so they're dwindling. But if you look at this sheet here, it's the one that's May 13th, 2002 town council meeting. Review of finance subcommittee recommendations, et cetera, et cetera. There is no notation of authorship here, but to whomever authored this white sheet, I'd like to say, shame on you. Shame on you. Things are misrepresented here, and let me share a little bit of a different perspective on it. And with that said, I'll be done. Starts off number one, school department FY03 revenues will be down $230,000, et cetera. It goes on to say, let me remind you, this is a one-town concept. What it should say is there's a loss of revenue sustained by the town due to the decrease in the state subsidy to schools. The second one, Town Council Finance Subcommittee has accepted the concept of Cape Elizabeth taxpayers this year will make up 100% of the $230,000 deficit, etc. Sounds very compelling, very interesting. First time I've heard it.
Excuse me, George. It would be really helpful. We're all up here scattering around our papers.
You don't know what's back there?
I'm not sure.
What's been provided to this audience?
I don't know. Could we just, is dated when?
Today?
It's this.
There's plenty of them back there if you want to take a look at this thing.
Should be one in front of you.
Number three, covering this net loss in school revenue will cost 31 cents per $1,000 of property value, et cetera. I beg to differ. there's a whole other way to look at this. I was trained as a psychologist. I was always suspect of the testing data, because you could make it say whatever you wanted it to say. Well, I beg to differ with whoever the author is in terms of the way that they presented this information. Yes, there is an impact of 94 cents. However, if you consider where the revenues have fallen, how some expenditures have happened, and certain savings, 60 cents of the 94 cents is due to the loss that we, the town and the schools, have sustained. There's an increase in the county assessment, yes, 16 cents of that 94 cents. No control over that, no control over the first item. Impact of the town budget, 11 cents. Impact of the school budget, 7 cents. Just a different way to look at the facts, but I think it's important that we get sort of a balanced perspective here. We're not talking about win or lose, and I think we need to set some agendas aside. Let me continue. In March 2002, the council told the town manager to hold municipal spending to a maximum of 3%. In the planning process, in the budget process, the town doesn't set a cap for the school board. Otherwise, it's absurd. Why would we do all of that work to represent the needs of the children in this town? If you set a cap, then it's done. So the letter meant nothing to us, only to know that you were imposing restraint. We appreciate that. Did a good job, and so did we. And we did a good job. On April 12th, the school board proposed a 5.34% increase in spending, the largest increase since 1995. Come on. It depends on how you look at it. With a balance in terms of figuring out where that bus belongs, that we will receive subsidy back for, looking at the savings in terms of the savings in terms of energy costs, and looking at some of the revenue that we didn't expect, guess what? That's a misstatement. In fact, it's the lowest budget in 4 years. Let me present it to you that way. It's a little bit different perspective than what these folks were reading. At the April 24th, 2002 workshop at the school board, the town council finance committee set a 4% limit on spending increases for the school. Why was it 4.0%? Why was it not 4.137%? Arbitrary? I don't know. Could it have been because the counselors, or some counselors, spent some time deciding what should be included in the budget and what shouldn't be included in the budget, basically added your numbers up and identified 4% as something that we could do, as long as we followed the specific items that you wished to decrease. Items, by the way, that I believe you don't have the full facts on. A 4% increase will result in the largest amount of school spending ever in Cape Elizabeth. As Tom pointed out, if you spend $1 more, it will result in the largest increase. It's a statement of the obvious. It's sensational. Paying for a 4% spending increase on top of making the $230,000 revenue shortfall, et cetera, again, I've gone over the specifics, and I've given you a little bit different perspective on that 94 cents. Zero growth in school enrollment this year, 1756 students. Next year, 1751 students. Does the council also purport to understand the specific needs of those 1,751 students? Or is that what we leave to this leadership team and the superintendent? If you say good job to them, mean it, and trust them. Median class size in the high school is 16 students. Incorrect. There are two facts here, and I'll give that to you. One is the consumer price index in the past year has been at 1.5%. True. The town council limited spending increase on the municipal side to 2.42%. Good for you. two good facts. And then the last one, I'm not even really sure what it means. This is not a win or lose situation. It's time to set aside other agendas, whatever they might be, and start looking at the needs and building trust and regaining the trust of this school board. It's time to do what's right. And spending money on education, in my opinion, is always right. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Good evening, Kevin Sweeney, 7 Phillip Road. For the first half of my comment, I think I'll put on my finance chair of the school board hat. And in that role, I would say to you that we have presented to you a budget. You have come back for whatever reason and asked us or told us to reduce that budget by $191,557 in some cents, which is your right to do. Subsequently, through 5 hours of meetings, the school board has identified $161,000 in reductions. We can do no better at this point, I believe. It is irrelevant to you what that $161,000 consists of. The fact that you know what it is irrelevant. That is the school board's choice as to where to bring those reductions. Okay, so certainly nobody can blame you for reducing freshman athletics. That's our choice. But I would ask you now, as finance chair of the school board, we have done our level best through this entire process. I don't think we can go beyond the $161,000. So I beg your indulgence in reconsidering the reduction you requested and adjusting that to the $161,000 that we have submitted to you. And further, I would ask your consideration in allowing us to select which part of the budget, whether expenditure or revenue, that $161,000 will consist of. Thank you. Now I will speak to you as Kevin Sweeney, resident of Cape Elizabeth. And former parent of Cape Elizabeth students. Now, they are no longer students. I am an empty nester. I just received an invitation to join AARP. Since I moved to Cape Elizabeth 12, 13 years ago, I have supported education in Cape Elizabeth through my taxes, through my personal contributions to items that were not funded by the school board. And I have done so gratefully and willingly. That is why I am in Cape Elizabeth. When I made the decision to abandon New York City for the benefit of my children and come to Maine, my second choice was to come to Cape Elizabeth. Why? Not because it was a nice community, but its reputation was that it had the best schools in the state, period, bar none. Frankly, I haven't found that to be true. One of the reasons I ran for school board 5 years ago. Regardless, I am now an empty nester. I have no intention of moving from Cape Elizabeth. I am also on a relatively fixed income by choice. I will continue to support education in Cape Elizabeth through my taxes and through my contributions. I don't know that I am better able or less able to afford that, but that is my individual personal role. People have complained that the taxes that go to education are forcing them to leave town. No one has ever come to me directly and said that except for Mr. Potenza. And I must say, Mr. Potenza is nothing if not consistent in that allegation. And I believe that it's not an allegation, that it happens to be true to some extent. To what extent, I have no idea. But I will tell you that each and every one of us paid for the education of someone's child, including our own, and each and every one of us are paying in some degree for the retirement of the senior citizens. That is all of us in the middle. That is the natural way of the way they do things in this country. So we will be judged by how we treat our youngest and our oldest. And I think we need to take a good, solid look at that and keep in mind that we owe both of them a fair shake. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else? Okay. Thank you very much.
Three-minute break.
Yeah, just a second. I want to thank everyone, first of all, for your thoughtful comments, your suggestions, and the spirit in which you offered them. Your input is very important to the governmental process, helps everyone make better informed decisions. And I just want to say before I turn this over to the rest of the council for discussion, that I want to note that even though the school board and the town council may disagree about some particular points, some facts, and may reach different conclusions, I hope that everyone appreciates the hard work that the school board, the superintendent, the school administration, the council, the town manager and his staff have put into this process. I want to emphasize that I truly believe that everyone in this discussion, and that includes everybody who spoke tonight too, has good intentions and is trying to do the right thing. Most cities and towns in Maine are facing economic challenges. That's not really a surprise. All you have to do is read the paper, one of the several papers that comes to Cape Elizabeth, to see that local school budgets are facing problems, many of them much more dire than ours. South Portland is trying to find millions of dollars to cut and most likely will be laying off teachers. Portland is cutting programs and staff to levels below last year's, and you know, there's all sorts of stories. I'm not going to go reiterate all those. But I believe there has been for years, and there still is now, strong support in Cape Elizabeth for our schools. I mean, I can look at this room full of people, and I include the people up here as well as the people out there. This is a room full of people who support the schools and who all think school spending should go up. We've got to remember what we're talking about tonight is how much of an increase we should give to the schools in a flat growth year. We're not talking about slashing the budget back below what it was. We're not talking about having to make cuts, major cuts. It is to be expected, I believe, that the two boards may have and probably will have differing points of view. Citizens should understand that the rule of the school board, and thank heavens for them, it's their job to be advocates for the schools and to maximize the benefits for school children. And it's good that they do that. That's an important role within our government. The town council's goal is somewhat different. It's to look out for the needs and concerns of all Cape Elizabeth citizens, not just those in one group or another. It's got to be for everybody. The council needs to weigh worthy and important needs and balance competing priorities for the town as a whole. The bottom line is that the school board members and the town councilors are doing their jobs not for fame, not for glory, not for the big bucks, certainly. They're involved because they genuinely want to serve their community and contribute to make Cape a great place to live. No matter how often we may disagree, I thank them for their service and their hard work, and I hope Cape citizens do also. Lastly, I want to take the time to thank everybody for informing yourselves, for giving your input. Your part in the process is critical, and it helps the school board and the town council gain a better understanding of what citizens think on the issues that face us, your representatives. On behalf of both boards, I thank you for your ideas, your time, your thoughtfulness, and your commitment. So now I will turn it over to the rest of the councilors. Are there comments from councilors, or do I hear a motion from a councilor? Where stand?
Madam Chairwoman, I was going to go through the, the number of items we have on here. Would it be fair to ask for a break first? Several people have nodded that they Just for 5 minutes, to get up and walk around or whatever.
Two-minute break? Do you feel a need for...
We can't all go to the bathroom in 2 minutes.
Okay, 5-minute break. I'm hearing that people need to go to the bathroom, and I've seen people going in and out. So can we take a 5-minute break before we start the discussion again? Thank you very much. So, 10:20, 10:21. There's also a bathroom at the bottom of the stairs.
I'm going to Jamaica. I won't be here for the vote.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay. Let's pick up where we left off. And my question was, do I hear a motion from a counselor or are there comments?
Well, are we just on item 122?
We are.
Yes, but we may, as I said way back at the beginning, before the public hearing, we may take things in certain blocks or not.
Okay.
I know Councilor Roberts wants to move something.
I was going to suggest that we take item 122 separately, and then items 123 through 130 separately, and items 131 through 141 separately. Perhaps I should list
separately, you mean together as a block?
Each block. And why don't I read them for benefit of the people in the audience and on television who may not have the agenda in front of them. Item 122 was a proposal to eliminate the spring cleanup week effective spring 2003 with an estimated annual savings of $15,000. That would be the first item. And then the second block that we could take up would be to set the public hearing on the proposed adoption of the annual municipal school and county budgets. Item 124, set the public hearing on the proposed sewer fund budget. 125, hearing on the Riverside Cemetery budget. 126, the museum at Portland Headlight. Item 127, proposed Berwick Church Fund budget. 128 is a hearing on the proposed Fort Williams Park Capital Fund budget. Item 129, set a public hearing on the proposed Thomas Jordan Trust Fund budget. And item 130, set a public hearing on the proposed rescue fund. So at this point, if people are at least comfortable breaking out into those blocks, I would move the first item, 122, the proposal to eliminate the spring cleanup week effective spring 2003 with the estimated annual savings of $15,000, that be put on the budget or on the public hearing as well for the, I believe it's to put on public hearing, do we not, as well?
Well, no.
Are we just acting on that one tonight?
It's the proposal, what you just said was move to eliminate spring cleanup week.
Okay, we can do that this evening then. All right. So that was a motion eliminate the spring cleanup that had been discussed by the Finance Committee.
So that's the motion before
yes.
us. Is there a second?
I'll second that for purposes of discussion. My question is, why aren't we doing this item the same way we're doing all the other items? Why are we...
Because you don't set this for public hearing. This is just an item we didn't vote on yet to eliminate.
But it's a budget issue, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean,
we can do whatever we want. If you want to amend the motion, set it for public
hearing.
Set
it for public hearing like we do everything else.
That works for me.
But we've eliminated several things from the budget that we're not setting for public hearing.
But this isn't the only one we've eliminated.
But we have the whole laundry list of everything else, all the fees and all that we're also going to do.
I'm going to defer to the manager, I believe. Mike, why do we have that item on as an item that's not, it doesn't say to set it to public hearing, it's just on the agenda?
Yeah, if you note, I'll find the heading up above, the town council is expected to set all items in the manner presented or an amended form for public hearings on Tuesday, May 28, 2002. It was envisioned that you would set this for public hearing. Mm. The reason, to answer the other part of the question, the reason this item is spelled out is because it was when Ann and I were putting together the council agenda per the council rules, we discussed the fact that this particular issue was one that would probably result in public comment, and that if the council does ultimately decide to eliminate it, it would be best to have done so after there's been a full opportunity for public comment, so that when spring 2003 rolls around, you know, the comments won't come, well, you never gave us a chance to speak, you didn't know, we didn't know that it happened. That's why, because it is a significant, could be a significant public issue, it is spelled out here alone.
If I could add, it was one that we had received some questions on and was anticipated that there would be questions on, and that's why it's highlighted.
Then it would be appropriate just to refer this to the public hearing as well.
Right.
So I, John, if you'll back off your second, I'll make the motion to that effect.
That's fine.
It would be to put the spring cleanup elimination to a public hearing on...
So are we...
Tuesday, May 28th.
I have a process question here. Are we amending, are we amending your initial motion to lump this all together so it'll be 122 through 130, all the public hearings?
It could fit in with all the others, but we're set out on the agenda this way, isn't it? We can...
Works for me.
Do you want to amend?
Fine, I'll amend it, yeah.
Amend, it's okay to...
Yes, that's right.
So the motion...
The motion is to take all of them as a block, 122 through 130, which are all the public hearings for all the, for the municipal, school, county budgets, and then all the special fund budgets, and also to deal with the proposal for eliminating spring cleanup.
Correct.
For spring 2003. So that's been moved and seconded.
And seconded. Now the...
Is there discussion on the, on setting these public hearings? And there's no discussion. It's been moved and seconded. All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you.
So what I, the next motion would be the adjustment of various fees, item 131, 132. Do you want me to repeat them again just for clarity? Or do we need to? Yeah, the block.
131 through 141?
The fee ones. Right. Items 131 through 141, that the fee adjustments, I'm moving that they be sent to public discussion, tabled or to be sent to the May 28th town council meeting, at which time they may be adopted.
A point of order.
Yeah.
The recommendation is that they be tabled until the May 28th.
I took the word table, and I don't believe we want a table, do we? We do, that is the correct terminology?
I believe so.
Okay.
It wasn't envisioned. You'd have allow public comment on all these, but not a formal public hearing.
Right.
So, okay. Then, items 131 through 41, I would move that we table them to the May 28th town council meeting, at which may time they may be adopted.
I'll second that.
It's been moved and seconded. Discussion? All in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you. Any further comments? Or are we moving on?
Where do we end up at? At 142.
142,
okay.
Yeah. So now we're...
140.
It's 140.
Yeah, now it goes to...
But this is...
Cutting through the asparagus.
That's the end of the Finance Committee recommended items. Item 142, consideration of report from the Appointments Committee regarding vacancies on boards and commissions. Councillor Berry?
Help.
Do you want to recommend that we table this?
I didn't receive anything in my packet.
Right. I didn't either.
The staff had heard a discussion that you might be recommending someone as Riverside Cemetery trustee, but apparently that hasn't
been done. I don't think we got that back yet. I didn't hear we did.
So should we table it? Yeah. You want to make a motion to table it?
I've moved to table that for now, until June.
Second. Table to June.
Right.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion?
I think May 28th is going to be a little busy.
All in favor? It's unanimous.
I know it.
Item 143, consideration of authorizing the town manager to apply for a sewer connection for 1226 Shore Road.
Yeah, under this proposal, we would apply for the sewer connection fee, sewer connection permit. When the town applies for a sewer connection permit, we don't pay a fee, it's exempt. And then the actual connection would then be paid for by the by the purchaser of the property. So this merely authorizes the town manager to apply for the permit and obtain it prior to the property being sold.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Discussion? Jack?
The request from the potential buyer was to do that, or was it to actually hook the building into the sewer first?
This was in keeping with the request from the buyer.
That is in keeping with the request? Okay.
Any further questions or discussion? Been moved and seconded. All in favor? Yes, unanimous. Item number 144, consideration of proposed lease renewal for space for the Cape Courier at Town Hall. Anything to say about this, Mr. Manager?
No, other than it increases their rent 100%.
Okay. Do I hear a motion?
I'll move that the lease be renewed.
Okay. Do I hear a second? Okay. It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion?
Can I make it? I mean, what did you say? Increasing the...
Yeah, they've paid a really de minimis rent. It's been $50 per...
Sure, but it's sort of a public service.
Per month, and it's going up to $100 under the proposal.
$100 a month?
$100 a month.
Okay.
And their board of directors has reviewed it, and even though it comes in a very competitive climate for advertising,
right,
they agree that it's not an unreasonable request.
Okay. As long as they can handle it.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Any other discussion? All in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you. Item 145, consideration of updating the open space impact fee based on the 2000 census.
At this particular fee, you're not changing really anything other than it's based on the census. The earlier fee was based on the 1990 census, and this merely just updates it so that it's provided so that it's based on the 2000 census.
Yeah.
Again, no one's ever paid this fee. They've always given land or done something else instead. But in case someone did want to pay the fee, it would be based on the 2000 census amounts, and not on the 1990 census amounts.
Do I hear?
Is this something that has to be set for public hearing?
No.
Just a policy decision.
Councilor McGinty?
I move that we update the space impact fee based on the 2000 year census.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion?
I guess I'm showing my newness to the council, but I have a concern about how this impact fee can affect the cost of housing. We're already a community that is priced out of the reach for so many young families. So I would like to see this item tabled to another month when we have more time to discuss it. But I'm primarily concerned, recognizing it's never been levied, whether you donate land or have a dollar sign, we are impacting the cost of housing. So I'd like to just have a discussion of this in relation, I guess, to what we're doing with affordable housing. I don't know what's going on at Cross Hill. I know that there were some houses dedicated, and so I would move to table this.
I'll second the motion. I don't understand.
It's not debatable at this point.
It's a motion.
There was a motion already.
Is that to the June meeting?
But there was
takes precedence.
Already
tabling takes precedence.
Tabling takes precedence. That's right.
And then it's non-debatable.
So it's been moved and seconded.
Just a clarification, was the tabling to a certain date?
I would table it to the June meeting.
It's been moved and seconded to table item number 145 to the June meeting. There can be no discussion. All in favor of tabling?
How are we doing?
It's four. Four in favor, all those against, three. So, yes, we will table it. Table to June. Okay, item number 146, consideration of a proposal from Councilor Marianne Lynch regarding parking fees at Fort Williams Park. Councilor Lynch.
Thank you. What I've proposed is something that a number of people have mentioned to me, and I think to all of us on the council from time to time, and that is trying to, and in fact it was mentioned here tonight, trying to make Fort Williams a revenue neutral sort of place. And my proposal before the council tonight is simply to direct the town manager to investigate the implementation of a parking fee and decal system at Fort Williams Park and to report back to the town council by September 1st, 2002. I'm also asking that his investigation include consultation with the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, and his report shall include the means of accomplishing the implementation of a parking fee and decal system, including a proposed implementation date, cost, and revenue impacts. I think that if we can direct the town manager to do this, and he assures me he can do this without any additional money to do a study, we can have a discussion on the merits sometime this fall on the issue of whether or not there should be any kind of parking fee at Fort Williams. One thing I'm trying to avoid in this, because we already know that next year's state budget looks bad, is I don't think looking at this issue in the January-February time period when we're really struggling to create and have our own budget, that we will be able to review this in the deliberative manner that it needs and take a long-term view. So I'm trying, by doing this and proposing it now, to get it out of our budget cycle so that we can consult with the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, do a study, and have a debate on the merits outside of the budget cycle, which may bring more short-term thinking. So that's the proposal that I have before you tonight.
Thank you very much, Councilor Lynch. I'm sorry, getting a little late.
Whatever.
Here. So have you made a motion?
I would move. I thought I did, but I apologize. I
move. Maybe I drifted. I heard a recommendation. I didn't hear an actual.
Before you.
Yeah, there was.
Before you make the motion, we have an understanding, at least from my perspective, that that would also include how this, if this were implemented, how it would be enforced, who would, how, what the process would be to enforce it, whether rangers would be able to presumably write parking tickets, I guess, is what the enforcement mechanism would be, or we would have to have officers come down. You know, I don't want to see us tying up officers writing parking tickets at the park when they need to be out patrolling our roads. So as long as the enforcement element of that would be part of the process.
I agree with you, and I guess I looked at that as broadly within the rubric of the cost and revenue impacts, that if there's a cost to enforcement, we need to evaluate that. So
well, I just want to throw that out so he could keep that in mind when he's doing his research.
Okay.
He's all ears.
Can I just make comments in opposition to studying this? And I wrote down some things to make my case. The Fort Williams Advisory Committee has considered having an entrance fee, and that's not exactly what you're talking about, but I think they've considered parking and fees three times, at least in the last 10 to 12 years. And in each time, and the most recent one they studied really thoroughly, I think, they said no. I think it was unanimous each time. I think we would be, as a community, be open to criticism for being an exclusive community trying to close off this wonderful asset that we have. I think it could also start other towns doing the same thing. South Portland could charge a parking fee at the Bug Light. People from Cape Elizabeth go to the Bug Light, and I mean, that's a wonderful park and place for us to enjoy as a region. Maybe they'd start charging fees at Back Cove, and we wouldn't be able to avail ourselves of walking around the cove. I think it would create parking problems in the Oakhurst and the Sherwood Forest area or along Shore Road because people would be avoiding the parking fee. I think there'd be a reduction in the sales, possibly at the gift shop, the museum, and that's supporting the fort now, so I'm not sure we'd be gaining that much. And I guess one of the big things is that a number of years ago when we had improvements to the park, we used federal dollars from the Parks and Recreation, and those federal dollars said that we could not charge residents from outside of Cape Elizabeth different from the residents in Cape Elizabeth. And I think this would set up that kind of thing. So I can't support this proposal.
Thank you, Councillor Fritz. Is there other discussion?
Well, I'll just weigh in because I did speak with Councillor Lynch earlier today about this, I know that it's couched carefully in the survey, informing, getting information sort of thing, but I personally have stood forever as philosophically opposed to fees in this particular facility. And I personally continue to believe that for a variety of reasons, all of which I will save for later, but I certainly agree with Councillor Fritz has said, and I want to be helpful, but I cannot support this at this time because I so philosophically firmly believe that this is not where we should be charging fees. And I know that these sorts of things happen. You get into budget crunches, and I respect the fact that you are choosing to do it at a time after we finish this budget and before we go into the next one, which takes that pressure off, and I agree with that. But I'm just going to vote no. I'll save my comments for later.
Thank you, Councillor Carson. Councillor Roberts.
I think both Councillors Carson and Fritz have summed up my thoughts as to where I stand on it right now. Mm-hmm. But given what people have said, they would like us to look at it as studies. It's going to be a real hard sell for me to change my mind. I think it would put us in the light of being an elitist community. We don't have an awful lot in our community that we can offer to the residents elsewhere. We're using all of the services in Portland and South Portland that we don't get charged for. But I don't have a problem having it studied and looked at, and then we can see. And maybe they can show me that we should do it. I'm going to try and keep an open mind on it. Okay. But it will be a hard sell. But at least if we've done this survey and it's in front of us, if it's clear and evidence that we should be doing it, then I'll support it. But it's going to have to be very clear that we're gaining a lot more than we're losing by doing that. But I'll support the idea of at least having it studied again.
Thank you, Councillor Roberts. Who was the second?
Henry.
Henry.
Councillor Lynch make this motion.
She did make a motion.
You second.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for clarifying that. Councillor McGinty.
I've consistently also been against fees at the park, but as I told Councillor Lynch earlier, as what Councillor Robert just said, to study it one more time, that's fine. We can look at it again. I'll throw another study in my file on Fort William fees. But as Councillor Robert said, it's going to have to be compelling, the cost, cost analysis, benefit, cost, benefit, whatever.
It's late.
Yes. For me to support implementing something like that. But again, I'll support studying it again. That's fine.
I support the motion because I think we should study it. I have always in the past been against instituting parking fees because I thought there would be problems with traffic and personnel and it would be costly and I wasn't sure how much money we'd get out of it and would it be worth it, and et cetera, et cetera. But I think exploring the concept of parking fees for non-residents is one of those stones that we should not leave unturned sometime during the year. I agree it's probably best to do it when we're not in the heat of the budget season, but I really think it's worth looking at again. I think the economy has changed. I think the situation has changed. I'm aware that there are some innovations in parking lot and parking meter technology these days that I didn't know about a few years ago, and there might be a relatively low impact way to look at it, and it would be a chance for us to perhaps attain some substantial revenue for the town, and heaven knows the town can use it. Again, it's a matter of priorities. So I support looking at it. I have no idea what the study will show, and we will all decide at that point what to decide when it's time to decide it. But for now, I'm supporting the proposal to study it. Councillor Carson.
Could I ask to the manager, is it 10 cents a person? What did we figure that the support of the fort is? Is it about, comes out to 10 cents a citizen?
About $100,000 a year.
Yeah.
Out of the general fund. So if you're doing it per capita basis, you divide that by
9,000 individuals, that's about $10.
$10 a person is about the cost to support that.
So the town is subsidizing it by 100, about 100,000.
88,000.
Does that include what we put into the fort from the gift shop?
No, I don't think so, does it?
The gift shops, don't the gift shop sales go towards the Portland Headlight Fund?
But the area around.
It can be used for.
For the, yes, for the parking lot and things down there, yes. That goes back to support the area right around the headlight.
It's hard for me, when listening to tonight's conversation from the citizens that spoke and their passion for the children, the parents who spoke for the passion for the education, that the trade-off isn't that every time you let five cars in over a course of a year, that you can now buy one teacher's salary. I mean, the trade doesn't work that way. You know, these are it's one town, separate entities, and I know it's hard, but every time somebody would say, if we took a stone out of the wall and we charge fees in the parking, we'll get one teacher or we'll have one program, and the trade just doesn't work that way for me. But anyway, let's do our vote.
Okay. Well, shall we move the question? All those in favor of the proposal to study the concept of parking fees at Fort Williams, all those in favor? 5. Opposed? 2. Thank you. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. I see a couple citizens still here. Tell me, is there anything else on the agenda? I hear nothing, so we don't have any further items on the agenda.
I'll move adjournment. Second.
Yes, I do want to mention, first of all, I want to thank again everybody who was here. I want to thank the council for their attention and consideration of all the points of view that were expressed tonight. And I want to remind everyone that the next meeting of the town council is on the 28th, May 28th, when we will be doing formal public hearings on the various budget funds, and we will be having a special meeting at that night. But there will be an opportunity for public input at that public hearing, too. So, thank you very much, and good evening.
Well, I'm happy to get